Bun B is from Port Arthur in Texas. It's like a 90-minute ride from Houston, I guess.
About an hour and a half away.
He's part of a group called UGK, who released their first album 20 years ago in 1988, called The Southern Way. They had their first number one record last year, almost 20 years later, which for hip-hop obviously is kind of ridiculous time span, and he's still around, so one more time, give it up for Bun B.
Thank you again for having me, thank you.
So when Chuck D was on this couch this morning, or this late morning, he called you an analog person. Would you agree with that? Would you be fine with that?
Oh, absolutely. Chuck D would understand. I come from the age of recording on 2-inch reels. And before Pro Tools and Digital Performer and all these things came into play, recording, you know, back then in the early days was, one, it was more time consuming because you know, say for example, if I had to redo a vocal take, then you have to stop the machine, rewind, wait for the tapes to rewind, wait for all the tracks to lock back up in, and then go again. Whereas digitally, it's just a 2 taps of the space bar. You know what I'm saying? So, but that being said, a lot of the people who came into the music industry working on 2-inch reels, they have a better understanding of how music and vocals laying to tape have just a little bit deeper and a little bit warmer sound than a digital sound. And it's really a personal preference. I can do both, and I have done both. But with the UGK records, we always try to bring everything to the 2-inch reel, because when you're a DJ, I know we have a couple of DJs in the house. You did a great job last night, by the way. And you know, sometimes you have records, and some of them they just hit so much harder than the other records. And really, it's got a lot to do not just with the mixing and mastering, but the actual recording process.
So I think we'll have to talk about the special sound you introduced to the game a bit later. But first of all, Port Arthur. I don't think too many people are familiar with this place. So could you break down how it looks like there?
Absolutely.
How life is like there?
Port Arthur, Texas is a very small refinery town in southeast Texas. The town next to it, Beaumont, Texas, is where the largest oil drilling in the world has ever happened. The spindle top, at its peak, it was releasing 100,000 gallons of oil a day. And the whole area, the city that I come from, Port Arthur and Beaumont and all the other neighboring towns, are all built off of the refinery. So if you don't work in the refinery, you don't have a good job in that area. There's only 50,000 people in the whole town. There's only 2 high schools, you know, 3 elementary. So everybody knows everybody. You know, it's not too much anonymity in Port Arthur, Texas. Not many rich people in Port Arthur, Texas. When I say rich in a small town like that would be someone with 6 figures. Most people who live in Port Arthur and work in Port Arthur probably don't make more than $35,000 a year, American. So it's not necessarily poverty, but most people in the town are just getting by. My mother was a nurse, my father was a janitor, and so, you know, no big crazy house for me, small house, small bedroom, but big love, you know what I'm saying? And one thing about when you're from a small town, you know, or a small village or whatever it is, you have a deeper sense of community with people. You don't make fair weather friends. Usually, you know, where I'm at, most of the friends that I have will probably be my friends for the rest of my life. You don't have to worry about personalities changing over you. You pretty much know how everybody is. And because of where I and my partner Pimp C were raised in the small town, it affected the way we communicated with the world, not just through music, but personally. We wanted to make sure that people understood us. We were always a group that never wanted to put a wall up between the people that listened to their music, because there was no walls where we came from. Everybody knew everybody. You know, you could just be sitting in a living room and somebody walk up and just come in the screen door, "What's up, man? What y'all doing over here?" type of thing. So we wanted to make sure that as a group and with our music that we were as open to people as our city was, you know?
I think what's kind of interesting is that obviously you've been associated with Houston because it's the next big city and, right, and everything. But you never really claimed that. You always represented PA, Port Arthur, and that was really important for you. I think a lot of other people would have said, "Yeah, we're from Houston," pretty much, just to make it easier to get a foothold in the industry. Why didn't you ever do that?
Well, you know, being from a small town, when you are from a small town, most people in those towns have a lot of pride, you know, in their community. And it's one thing that we definitely had. You know, we love being from where we're from. It made us the people we are. You know, I think we're pretty good people. So for us, we knew that a lot of the people in that small town would probably never leave that town. They would never go out in the world. They would never be able to go and see things. Most of the people I know that I grew up with, they've never left Texas, much less the US. So for us, it's important to let them know that no matter where we went in the world, that we represented for them, for the people who couldn't go out into the world. It's very easy. It would be very easy for me to just say Houston every time somebody asks me something about where you're from, what you represent. It'd be easy for me to say Houston, but you know, the easy way has never been the way we've taken it. We always wanted people to respect us for who we were. We never wanted to try to, you know, fancy it up or dress it up a little bit. We're from a small town, Port Arthur. You either like it or you don't. You either accept it or you don't. You know, either way, we're going to make this music. We're going to be here. We're not going anywhere. You know what I'm saying? And for me, it feels good to be in Los Angeles and New York and even in Barcelona and be like, Port Arthur's in the house. You know, when those people see those moments on TV or on the internet and things like that, it uplifts them because it's very easy for a person to forget where they came from. It's very easy once you, quote, succeed in the music industry to forget the little people. But for us, we are the little people. We're the underdogs. That's why the group is called the Underground Kingz, because we were always the guys that nobody thought could do it, because we came from a town full of people that people thought couldn't do it and would only be who they were. So it was important for us to let people know, you know, don't think you know everything about me just because I'm from a small town. Like, you know, I can take it wherever I need to take it.
So I guess it was 8Ball MJG. They refused to call to have their music called hip hop. They say they make country rap. Can we relate to that state of mind?
You know, a lot of times, you know, when in our early days of coming up, you know, hip hop and, you know, a lot of the movement, for whatever reasons, they didn't want to include us. You know, there was, I guess, a geographical distancing or whatever, but I think people just didn't think we knew what we were talking about. You know, in the South, they didn't think we had the same appreciation. And when you really think about it, hip hop is more of a lifestyle. Hip hop is not just music. Hip hop is, of course, MCing, DJing, breakdancing, and graffiti, you know, but we're just MCs. So what we do may be considered part of hip hop, but we are not hip hop. And we just really wanted to carve out our own identity since, you know, it was like, well, we can't be a part of what they're doing. So we're gonna do what we do and just make sure that people fully understand that it is of itself, primarily just from this area. Now, saying that, we never wanted to exclude ourselves from other people, you know what I'm saying? And we didn't want other people to not get into what we were doing. We just wanted people to understand what the core of what we were doing meant. You know, with us being Southern people in America, when you're from, if you don't live in a major metropolitan city, they call you country. It's basically that simple. You country, or they say like you Bama type of situation like that. So with me, I don't mind being country. I love being from the country. I love being from small towns. And if you think something's wrong with that, then obviously you out of your rabbit ass mind, you know?
But still, how important was Houston as a city for you to become the MC you are now? Like when you were younger, did you go there often to clubs, record stores, whatever?
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, that was the hub for anything, any and all things rap and hip hop in Texas, as far as I knew. You know, if you wanted the new albums, you either had to order them specifically or you could just ride to Houston and Houston would have them. Same thing with concerts. We didn't really get a lot of concerts in Port Arthur. Only concert I remember us getting as a rap concert was the Ghetto Boys, and that wasn't until like 90, 91. So for us, if we really wanted to see something or know something about rap, we had to get in the car and drive an hour and a half, go to record stores, go to the flea market. You'd have to bring your radio with you so you could cut on the local radio show. They would have like rap shows on Saturday night. The university in Houston, Texas Southern University, has a communications department and they have a radio station. And it used to do a 2-hour show called Kids Jam. And Kids Jam would basically debut all the new rap records. So in Port Arthur, unless you had a real big antenna at your house, you couldn't catch the radio in Houston. So, you know, when we would ride out to Houston on the weekends, we would bring a radio with us and tape the shows and then bring the shows back home and play them for people.
So the production, was that all Pimp C back then? Or were you involved in any of the records as well?
I did a couple of tracks in the beginning, but I realized that I was just making beats, that I wasn't a producer, because there's a difference. I don't think a lot of people realize that. Probably anybody in this room can make a beat. You know, somebody show them how to cut on the MPC and play a little keys. You don't even have to know how to play the keyboard.
I can't.
I know you can.
No, I can't.
No, you can. Trust me, I said the same thing. Take a record, a turntable, and a fucking sampler, and a drum machine, and anybody can make a beat. But that doesn't make you a producer. Being a producer is knowing the right kind of sound for the records, hearing the whole song inside of your head before you even touch the first instrument. People like that, that sit there and you hear them and you see the eyes roll back and doom, 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 doom. I'm like, what you singing? That's some shit that I'm thinking. I think I'm finna make this song. And then they'll go in there, and when you go in there and you hear the beat and it's doom, 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 doom. I'm like, how the fuck did you even know how to get that shit out of your head into a fucking machine on tape like that? That's the difference between a beat maker and a producer.
So were you always around when Pimp made the beats, or was it more like he did it in his studio or whatever at home and then brought you the beats and you rapped on that?
No, we would sit around and he would, you know, Pimp would make beats all day. You know, most producers, that's pretty much what they do. They wake up, they go to the machine and they start making music. They'll probably make 4 or 5, sometimes even as many as 10 songs, but most producers I know will make it, listen to it, you'd be like, damn, that shit dope. And they'll be like, nah, that's bullshit. Clear the whole board. I'd be like, what the fuck is wrong with you? Like, man, that shit was garbage. And they'll start again. They'll be like, damn, actually, that's better than the last shit. Yeah, but I don't like the drums. Fuck that shit. I'm like, come on, man, what you doing? And you'd be like, no, man, if we're going to do it, it's got to be perfect. Every song, we can't put out half-assed music, not if we care about what we're doing and not for who we represent, because people where we're from don't get a second chance. So when we come, we got to come with it. And he was always right.
So the Tell Me Something Good record, do you remember how it came about when you recorded it?
Yeah, we did that record actually at Pimp C's, at his mom's house. All the first album, all the pre-production was done at Pimp's mom's house. But Tell Me Something Good specifically, we had originally started doing all the music in Pimp's bedroom because he only had a little keyboard and a little sampler and a little Dr. Rhythm drum machine and shit. We were making everything literally in the bedroom, rapping on a Radio Shack microphone. So then we started like saving up money and investing in bigger equipment. We all went in and got an Insonic. And once we got the Insonic, it was too big for the bedroom. So his mom was like, well, y'all can put that shit in the den, but let me know when y'all gonna make that music so I can, you know, go in my room or something. But, you know, we were making music that at first, you know, his stepfather, Monroe, you know, he would just call it noise because he was from a different generation. He didn't really understand it. And, you know, that's a lot of the older people would just call it noise. So for us, we wanted to incorporate records into our records that we knew our parents listened to and was the shit for them. And we were just going to put our little rap spin on it and make it happen. So Tell Me Something Good, the original record was by Rufus featuring Chaka Khan. Anybody over 30 years old in the U.S. knows this record. You know what I'm saying? It's a major record. It's always a party starter. My mother loves the record. His mother, everybody's mom loves the fucking record. So we was like, shit, we do Tell Me Something Good, and you know, at least they won't complain about that one. You know what I'm saying? And so every album we wanted to try to pull some of those old records that we knew people loved from a different generation, just so they would be able to have a chance to get into us a little bit. You know, they weren't gonna listen to Pocket Full of Stones, but maybe we can get them to listen to One Day. You know what I'm saying?
I guess then let's listen to the Tell Me Something Good first and absolutely, the other records you mentioned as well.
Yeah. pull or come and jack me. Better bring a gang load of homies when you think you wanna go. Cause by yourself, you're running to the flow. I've seen your kind before, man, you're nothing with your hands. More than a punk, but still less than a man. You talk a lot, and when you're chilling with the ladies, let me catch you by yourself, you're pushing up some daisies. Crazy you wanna be, but punks with no heart ain't hard. You're just waiting for Bun to pull your card. You better keep your weak self locked in your hood, cause without your boys, I'ma have to tell you something good.
Tell me something good.
Wow. I'm 35 years old. I was 18 when I made that. I sound fucking crazy at 18. Like, wow, I was trying real hard to be, for people to know I was hard back then. I hear it in my voice, like, what's up with that? What the fuck was wrong with me? That's actually crazy that you found that version. The version that he just played is the actual original version that we recorded. When the record company got ready to put the album out, they pulled the sample because they told us it didn't clear, but then I found out later that they just didn't want to pay for it. You know what I'm saying? So that's the kind of shit record companies do to you. But that's it. That's the first song we actually went into what you would call a full functioning recording studio. That was the first rhyme I recorded, like, on the reel. Like, all of that, like, actually going to the studio and be like, yeah, you know, we went to the studio today. And I mean, we took the tape off the studio and we brought it to the house and put it up on the wall. Like, that's our first track list. Look at this shit. We tracked the song out. That shit was big for us. Because where we were from, nobody, only other people to make music from Port Arthur, Texas were Archie Bell and the Drells and Janis Joplin. You know what I'm saying? So you're looking at the 60s and the 70s and then nothing for like 30 odd years, you know what I'm saying? So to us, it was a big accomplishment, not just for ourselves, but for Port Arthur people, period, you know?
So what kind of music were you listening to back then? Since there was no hip hop or any music scene in Port Arthur, what was that? Was that New York rap or other Southern rap? Like, I don't know, South Park Coalition, stuff
you
like
would,
that?
You would be listening to, you could hear rap, like, you know, but most of the rap music out at that time was basically like the East Coast scene, you know, Juice Crew, Big Daddy Kane, Coogee Rap, that kind of thing. Of course, man, I remember the first time I heard Public Enemy, my Uzi weighs a ton. God damn, that was serious. I was a big bass head back in the day, you know, coming up. I like bass. You know, Houston, Texas, we have a real big car culture, like, you know, because of the fact that Texas is so big. You know, Texas still has a million acres of land that's not even civilized. Like, just that's just land. That's not even where people live at. It's just a huge fucking place. And unlike Europe, you can't get anywhere in Houston on a bike. Like, you'll be dead before you get there. You'll be tired, you'll be sweating, you'll be no good when you get there. So everybody has a car. And in order for your car to stand out from the other thousands of cars in the city, you're either gonna put the crazy candy paint or the rims on it, or you're gonna put a lot of music in it. Especially if you don't have money for rims and paint and shit like that. I remember when I was little, we would, you know, my mom would go to sleep. I would take the stereos, the speakers off the house stereo, lay them in the back seat of the car, and hook the wires up to the, we would have a battery. We wouldn't even play it through the car system. We would have like a radio that somebody took out of somebody's car and a car battery. And we would have that shit wired to the battery and the speakers wired to the radio through the outputs and be playing that shit like that. And just riding around, and people like, damn, that shit banging, what you got in there? Shit, my mama's speakers, you know? But I mean, that's what you do. You compromise in this world, you know what I'm saying? Everybody's not rich. Everybody can't afford to do and have what everybody else does, but that doesn't mean they can't be part of the party, you know?
So what was the music that was really big in Texas? Was that East Coast rap?
Or I would say,
how about bass music, like Miami kind of stuff? Was that any relevant?
Well, what it was is that we didn't even really look at that shit like that because it was still so new. Like, rap music really just started getting, I think, regionalized within the last 10, 15 years or so. Because back in 89, you know, when you listen to Big Daddy Kane, you didn't consider him an East Coast rapper. He was just a rapper. You know what I'm saying? You listen to N.W.A., you know, the only reason you would just really be like, those are West Coast people because they wore L.A. shit all day, every day. And, you know, then when the Southern rap started coming, you had, in the early days, DJ Magic Mike, With, you know, he would just make bass music, just tapes with just beats, with just stupid bass in it. No rapping, no nothing. That shit went gold. He was the only person I know of that went gold with a rap album that didn't rap. Like, what kind of shit is that? No video, no radio play, nothing, just because everybody wanted the bass and shit. Ghetto style DJ shit, you know, like the Gucci Crew, shit like that. MC Shadi, MC Twist. Shortly, the early Rap-A-Lot records, like You Gotta Be Down, Car Freak, that's from the first Ghetto Boys. The first Ghetto Boys were Jukebox, Johnny C, Bushwick Bill, and Ready Red. Scarface didn't get to the Ghetto Boys until the second album. So we were listening to that type of shit. And I remember listening to that first Ghetto Boys album and hearing shit like I'm an Assassin and Balls of My Word and just hearing this rap music and then hearing Houston in the middle of the rhymes. It'll fuck you up. You know what I'm saying? Like, wow, like Houston people are making rap music. You like, wow, that's crazy. I didn't even know they had some way you could even do that shit like that. So I was like, man, this rap shit is gonna be all right, you know? The next thing you know, people in my own town started rapping. I was like, oh, hell no. Because I was breakdancing, but I didn't really know too many people who was rapping. I may not look like it now because I'm a little bit past my prime, as you can see. But yeah, I used to be the suicide man. I used to be breaking and just bah, fall on my back and backspin and jump up, what's up now type shit. I can't do none of that shit no more. But yeah, I definitely, you know, East Coast, if you want to call it that, you know, definitely the early inception of rap, all those guys. And then once the West Coast came and really started making like more harder edge music, that's when I think Southern South was like, yeah, I think we can do that, you know?
So you say that it wasn't of any importance for you where rap came from. Still, like, early record was called The Southern Way. So what did you mean by that?
Well, you know, we just wanted people to see the way that we do things. We know everybody knows how in LA they're riding the subways. They go into the bodegas in LA. We know they gangbang and different things like that. And we just wanted to say, you know what? Well, you know, they have it their way. He has it his way. But down here, we do it our way, the Southern way, you know?
Was there any gangbanging in Houston back then?
No, not really. Not gangs like you see, like Bloods and Crips and anything like that. I don't think Houston got like Bloods and Crips till about maybe 5 years ago. Within the last 5-6 years, you would have people who would come from the penitentiary who would have affiliation through prison, but as far as just being on the streets, like neighborhoods just being blue or red, we didn't have that. That being said, South Side of Houston always was in the red, like red cars and things like that, but it was never a gang thing, and the North Side of Houston was always in the blues things, you know what I'm saying? But it had no correlation whatsoever to what was going on in LA. You had South Side people, you know, who didn't like North Side people and vice versa. You can find that damn near anywhere, though, you know. Anywhere you go and there's a South Side and a North Side, the motherfuckers don't get along.
Is that still
Korea, Ireland, all that shit, the motherfuckers don't get along. Yeah.
Is the whole South Side, North Side thing still an issue in Houston? I know it was quite a big issue ten years ago, maybe.
It got big during the screw tape scene. You know, a lot of problems came up out of the screw tape scene simply because the screw music was purely South Side, and you know they were talking about, you know, how much money they were making and the cars and all the shit they were doing, and you know North Side people were like, damn, it's not like we ain't doing it, like we balling, we making money, we doing the same shit, but they didn't really have, I guess, the outlet to represent that kind of thing. Michael Watts and them didn't come till a couple of years, you know, about 4 or 5 years after Screw, so. You know, it did get crazy for a while, but then again, even then, it was specific neighborhoods versus specific neighborhoods. It was never everybody from the North Side beefing against everybody from the South Side. It was people from Third Ward, primarily the Third Ward area, getting into it with, what was it, Rosewood? It was Rosewood cats on the North Side. And it even got on the tapes, like, yeah, boys from Rosewood trying to come through, but we strapped up at the after hours, it's whatever, and I mean, it was crazy for a while, because unless I'm mistaken, I think they had a bulletproof. They were robbing people in cars just as nice as the car they were driving. So when the car would pull up on you, you would just think it was another car, you know? And the next thing you know, they jumping out with AKs and shit. Then they jump in your shit, and then both cars is going down the street. You're like, what the fuck just happened? You know what I'm saying? But it would be like if somebody in a Rolls Royce pulled up in your Rolls Royce and then took you out your Rolls Royce and robbed you. It's that kind of a thing, you know. It was a nice, people jumping out of nice shit to take nice shit. It was crazy.
So you mentioned screw music. I think for us Europeans who grew up on like a healthy Pete Rock and Nas and Wu-Tang diet, it was always hard to understand what you guys were doing. But like screw music, when I first heard that, I was like, what's going on here? So
me too.
Yeah. When was that? When did you first hear about screw music?
I think my first screw, I want to be very, very specific about that too. I met Screw in 92 before the mixtapes were going on. Screw was, before the Screw tapes as we know it. At the time, Screw was just he was a mixtape DJ like everybody else. You know, he was making mixtapes and selling them. It was, you know, just a regular thing. And probably around the end of 92, towards late 92, I got one of his mixtapes and it was totally fucking different. Like the shit was all slow. So I brought the shit back. I was like, screw, man, my tape is fucked up. Like it's, cause if you remember back in the cassette days, I don't know how many, anybody here ever actually bought a cassette tape? All right, I like that shit. 10 years ago, did you buy a cassette tape? Like the ones to record on, not just like an album, but like when you buy a 90 or 100 minute cassette tape. If you would get the 100 minute ones, sometimes it'd be so much tape in that shit that it would get caught up. And especially back then, like, you know, like if you tape too much and your shit pop, then you have to get out and splice it and get some scotch tape and shit. Like, I mean, you had a little clear tape and patch the shit back up. Sometimes it would get too thick. Like me, I'd have something that was popped in two or three different places. So the shit would get all fucked up and caught up inside of it. So I was like, screw, my shit must be fucked up. Maybe it's too much tape or something in here. He was like, oh, my bad. He gave me another one. The shit sounded the same way. I said, man, this shit, something wrong with this one too. He's like, nah, man, that's how it go. That's how it's supposed to sound. I'm like, okay, all right. So I rolled around with it. I was like, I don't get this shit. And then I heard myself. I was like, whoa, nah, I really don't understand this shit. Like, my shit was never meant to be like this. So in my own mind, I couldn't really grasp the concept of that shit. Then one night I went out to the car wash on MLK, it was a Saturday night, and I heard it playing in a car with a lot of system, like a lot of bass in that motherfucker. And I heard how long that bass kick would last with the record being played at a third of the speed. I was like, that's what this shit is about. This shit is about making the bass even louder. You can play it even harder. I said, okay, maybe I can get used to this shit. Then when I smoked me a blunt or two, then it really started making a little bit more sense. I'm like, yeah, I can get into this shit now for real, because it was more mellow and laid back. It's not something that you have to be high to get, but you do need to be in a very relaxed state of mind. So if you can get yourself in your own personal Xanadu without doing drugs, that is beautiful. I absolutely recommend that. But if you're already doing something, then screw music is the perfect thing to do it to.
We could try it.
Yeah, it's going down. It's your boys, 3-6. The Hold Academy up. Award-winning Mafia. Call them on it, we want people. It's going down, man. Let's go. Come with your boys, folks out. OG Ron C and Wrecking Yard. You know what I'm saying? Chopped up, not slopped up. $40 in the club. Fucking dang, bitch, it gets good.
Now keep in mind, the Screw Tape still has all the traditional shit that an average mixtape has, as far as the trick scratching, the shout outs and all of that. The only difference is the tempo. And that was an original invention by Screw. And it's so crazy because very seldom do you have an invention named after the inventor. And when other people do it, it's like when Michael Watts and different people and the Beltway Boys and things like that started making these mixtapes, people got offended because they were saying it was screwed up. It was screwed, but like, Screw, only Screw can screw a mixtape. Like, how can you say, that's like saying I just bunned it. Like, how can you bun it if you not bun? You know what I'm saying? So it was a lot of beef. It was a lot of plex. I think it's still a lot of people that feel funny about it because it was one man's invention. You know what I'm saying? It was named after him, by him, for him, and then other people started doing it, but giving him no credit or no acknowledgement of the fact that it was his invention, it was his creation. And you know, there are people today who still feel like, you know, there are certain DJs who have not given it up enough to DJ Screw. I remember when Justo, rest in peace, that's crazy because they're both gone now, but Justo, who put together the mixtape awards in America for DJs, to honor DJs. I remember when they called Screw and told Screw to come up, they were giving him a special award for creating his own style of DJing. And it was like, man, I never thought they would fuck with me. That's all he kept saying. I remember he said, man, Bun, I never thought them boys would fuck with me. He said, I always thought they was hating. I would say, man, they just didn't get it. That's all it was. They just didn't get it. I could understand that because motherfuckers didn't get what we were doing for years, till years after the fact. But as a DJ and coming up on people like Grandmaster Caz and all these different guys that, you know, going up and meeting Flash and meeting Molly Mall and having these people like, yo, that's incredible what you did. And then I think they gave him a ring and he never took it off. Never took it off.
Was that important for you back then when you started out, that people from like other regions would feel your music or understand what we were trying to say and trying to do?
Yeah, because you know, like the same way we would listen to music and try to figure out, well, what the fuck is, what does Buck 50 mean? What the fuck does that mean? You would hear all these different regional slangs from different places, you know what I'm saying? And you would be like, damn, man, what does that shit mean? So you would have to keep listening to the records and kind of try to listen to the context of the record and take some kind of uneducated, misguided guess at the shit. So sometimes you got it right, sometimes you got it wrong, but a lot of it was just trying to, you know, figure out what it was they were into. And for us, we were just, you know, happy that people took the time to listen to our shit to try to figure it out and really get into our world, because that's what our music was really letting you into our world. You know what I'm saying? And for people to come in and to appreciate it and be like, yo, I liked it. And then when I found out y'all was talking about this, man, that's my shit now. You know what I'm saying? That's how I used to feel. That's how I still feel when I listen to shit. You know what I'm saying? What was I watching? I was watching this kid. I was in, where did we just left? We just left Denmark. Just left Denmark. And there's a kid, Bushido. He's not from Denmark, but he's a European rapper. German rapper, yeah. And I was listening to the song. I had no idea exactly what he was saying, but I get the text of it. He got, you know, he's saying ching ching, you know what I'm saying? Bling bling. Doing, it's a ghetto thing. I'm like, okay, that's what he's just talking about. He making money. And if you ain't from the hood making money, you probably don't understand him. Like, you don't need to understand German to get that shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just about the fact that people taking the time to get into what you're doing. You know what I'm saying? That's really what we make it for, to see if people really appreciate the effort put into it. Because for years, people didn't think rap really took much. People thought we were just rapping over, just saying shit over other people's records, and nothing could be further from the case.
So, I think for a kid who grows up with hip-hop nowadays, it's kind of impossible to imagine that it was a time where hip-hop from or rap music from the South wasn't that popular. I mean, today it's all about the Jeezys and the T.I.s and all of that. So when do you think that turned around? When did the South became what it is now?
Oh, when Mind Playing Tricks went to number one on the charts, and not just on the rap charts. It was the number one record in the country. And, you know, the Ghetto Boys and the 2 Live Crew, these people went out and they went to every one of these cities before any of us did. They went out there when we didn't know what people would think of us. They didn't care. J Prince and Ravelout Records, they basically formed the path that everybody walks now. You know what I'm saying? So it's easy for us to do it now. But back then, for one, being from the South, everybody assumes that if you're not just stupid, you're at least dumber than them. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just a given. So that's got nothing to do with music. That's just being a Southerner, just being a Southern person. They assume you're stupid, you're uneducated, you're ignorant, you're tacky, you got no fresh, no swag, none of that shit, and you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. So the first thing to do was to try to break that idea of that notion. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of that came through the lyricism of Scarface, with him being such an incredible writer, you know, and lyricist back then. And people just really had to give it up for the group. Like, yo, this dude here is a real fucking rapper. And then you had the braggadocio, Willie D, you know what I'm saying? Coming through like, yeah, this is the South, and you can call us country and all that you want, but if I hear you say it, I'm gonna beat your ass. And it was evident that, okay, I don't know what they doing, but that dude gonna kick somebody's ass. So if I don't like it, I'm gonna just keep quiet about it. You know, that's your best thing to do, is just be quiet. And then Bushwick was there to let you know, hey, it's still music, it's still a party, we're still having a good time. It's all right to dance, it's all right to laugh, it's all ready to have a little fun with it, you know. But the early days of those guys going out there, and you hear a lot of stories about them and going to these different cities and people thinking they were a joke, and there were so many towns that they had to fight their way out of, you know what I'm saying? But then they would come back to those same cities that they had to fight to get out of, and it would be kings because they had earned their respect. And that's really what it's about, not being scared to go out and say, you know what, I don't care if you don't like me today. You know what I'm saying? I'll be here tomorrow. Maybe you'll like me then. That's really what this is about when you're an artist trying to get into the game. Most people aren't going to like what you're doing. That's okay, because they probably just don't get you yet. And sometimes it takes a while for people to ride with an album. I remember the first time I heard The Chronic, I thought it was terrible. Most people I know thought it was terrible. Then the next day, everybody was like, yo, this is the shit. Because I remember we popped it in and we were like, damn, this The Chronic? This shit ain't better than NWA album. But then when you really stick, but it was so new. Everything Dre put in The Chronic was so new. The way they were structuring songs, the way they were producing, the way people were even rapping. Snoop and RBX and Corrupt and all these guys, they brought a whole new style of lyricism and interactivity into the game. And the shit was just a little bit too much to process, I guess, the first day. Then the next day we listened to it like, yo, I don't know what we was thinking yesterday. This shit is not just jamming. This is the most jamming shit I ever heard. It had to take me like two or three listens before I could really get into it and realize it wasn't just songs, it was an album. Because a lot of rap was just, you know, 8 songs, 10 songs, just random rapping about a girl, rapping about the club, rapping about the car, rapping about the neighborhood, rapping about peace, rapping about war, and whatever the fuck. You know, put your homeboy on the song and go on with it. The Chronic was a full thought out album from beginning to end. The way the skits were done, the music, the way it was put together, it was very fucking precise. You know what I'm saying? And I think it really changed the way people put shit together. I know it did for us, not in the fact to emulate it, but the fact to make sure that our shit has to stand out like this. When they put our shit in, they may not get it at first, but they keep listening to it, they gonna realize this shit is different. That's why I didn't get it, because it's just a little bit different than what I'm used to. This shit is good music, period.
So is that important for you when you create an album to do something like The Chronic was, you know, a coherent, consistent album?
Yeah, because like I say, most rappers is not consistent, it's not coherent, and it's just random thoughts over random beats. And you know what I'm saying? With that kind of shit going on, it's understandable why a lot of it gets criticized, because most people weren't putting a lot of effort into what they were doing. They weren't looking at it as a full project. Once, you know, rappers start realizing that we're not just making music, we're making albums, and we actually have careers. Because in the early days, nobody knew how long that shit was gonna go on. You know what I'm saying? But once people start realizing, okay, I got a record deal, I'm gonna be here, I got a budget in this, let me sit down and really concentrate on what the fuck I'm doing and how it's gonna be presented. You know what I'm saying? And that's really where the game started changing that with us. You know, when we were younger, we were just making songs about, you know, if we went out one day and we saw a dude in a nice car and, you know, women was jocking him, and we make a song the next day about women jocking the car. You know what I'm saying? But then when you start thinking, okay, we need to make a full album, we need to pick a theme, and we need to ride on that theme. You know what I'm saying? And that's what we started doing.
I think it's pretty common sense that the closest you got to create that perfect album was the Ride and Dirty record. Would you agree with that?
I kind of would have to. I mean, musically, we were probably in our prime for the time. Lyrically, we were definitely in our prime for the time, and we had a lot of shit going on in our personal lives too that affected a lot of Ride and Dirty. But more than anything, Ride and Dirty was the first album where, you know, Pimp and I got to do every song we wanted to do the way we wanted to do it. We got to put the album together the way we wanted to put together. We got to do the cover artwork the way we wanted to do it. It was the first time when the record company said, you know what? You guys know what you're doing. Because even the record company thought we were stupid. Remember, we from the South. We don't know what the fuck we're doing. So they would be like, well, that's a good song, but people in LA aren't gonna get that, so you probably need to do this. Well, I didn't make this for people in LA to get it. I made it for people, period. It don't matter where you're from. I'm not concerned about making something that New York is gonna jam. If it's good music, they'll jam it anyway. You thinking about radio and what the people you hang around with are gonna think about the record, I could give a fuck about that. Get that shit to the man on the street and he gonna dig it. Their problem was they were scared. So they would only service it to people in the South in the street. I used to go to New York, look for my album, I couldn't find the shit. I'd be like, where's my shit at up here? Like, oh, well, we got it in a couple of places, but we don't think people, how the fuck you know what, it's 8 million people in New York, you assume they know what the fuck 8 million people think? Really? Why y'all don't sell more music then? If y'all knew what the fuck people wanted to hear, wouldn't y'all be billionaires? Like hundreds and hundreds of billions? Every record you put out would be number one around the world. Bullshit, y'all don't know what you're doing. Get a shit a chance. Ride and Dirty was the first time they said, you know what, the screw shit, and the candy paint, and the cars. I think people can get it. I think people might be able to get it. So I'm like, duh, no shit, motherfucker, because you see Screw Tape selling all over the fucking world now. You know what I'm saying? We've been telling you about Screw for 3 fucking years. Like, Screw is the shit, Screw is the shit. Now all of a sudden, man, you know that shit y'all talking about Screw? I think it might not. You don't think, you know. Let's be real about it. So like, you know what? We're going to let y'all do your thing. Do the album, make the music, bring it back in. You know, this is the budget. Even though we went over the shit. This is the budget, make it on the budget, and we'll put the shit out. And that's what we did. They left us the fuck alone. And we made the album we supposed to make.
So then let's listen to a song, maybe, off the album.
All right. And if you're an artist in here, fight for your individuality. Like, don't just take what the fuck a record company tells you. Argue with the motherfuckers. Call your A&R a son of a bitch. Don't be scared to, because they just people. They can't hurt you. You know what I'm saying? Just tell them how the fuck you feel. They'll actually respect you a lot more for it, believe me. I call my CEO a bitch. That wasn't a good one. They didn't answer the phone for 2 months, but that's all good. But when they did answer the phone, they knew who they was talking to.
By the way, talking about labels, I remember there was a situation when you put out an album and didn't do any promo for that. Which record was that? I think it was the last one you did as UGK before the Underground Kingz?
Yeah, that probably would have been Dirty Money. Yeah. And we didn't do anything. But that was because it was just a lot of bullshit with them. You know, we finally had the big record with Jay-Z, the big pimpin', and that was something that they could understand. Okay, it was Jay-Z, it was Timbaland, it was a hit record. So let's just do another one. And then y'all can have a big hit record like that. I'm like, that's not a UGK song. That's a Jay-Z song. We don't do Jay-Z songs, we do UGK songs. They're like, yeah, but still, you know, everybody knows you from this. I don't give a fuck what people know me from. That's not how I wanna be presented from my project. If that's how he wants to present me on his shit, that's cool. But when it comes time to my shit rolls different. With no disrespect to Jay or Timbaland, and they wanted Hype Williams to shoot a video and all that shit. I say, so let me get this straight. If I go get Jay-Z and Timbaland and do another song, y'all'll pay, you know, $500,000 for Hype to shoot the video. But if I don't get Jay-Z or Timbaland, will Hype still shoot my video? Well, let's not concentrate on that. That's just simple questions. If we do this shit and we don't put them on there, is it gonna be a Hype Williams video? Probably not. Gotcha. Fuck you and this album. We're going to turn it in and then you do what you want to do with it.
So, but we still need to talk about the Jay-Z song later, but maybe first listen to a UGK song.
Absolutely.
As you put it. Here we go. That's one off the Ride and Dirty.
Well, 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 well. then you're gone.
So I start selling crack cocaine and codeine. Time to stack some paper, I gotta do it quick. Thinking I'm a juvenile, but they don't know who they messing with. Yeah, my mama's only son, but I live every day like it's my motherfucking last one. Every nigga and they mama asking why, but I'm in the game, live by the game, and in the game I'ma die. And if I die, or should I say if I go, bury me in Horn Clark next to the come and go. Cause tomorrow ain't promised to me. The only thing promised to a player is the penitentiary. So I'ma take care of my business on the smooth tip. Watch my back selling crack and pack two clips. And when you think about that, you say it'll be on as a trip you're here today. But the next day you're gone.
One day you're here, baby, and then you're gone. One day you're here, baby, and then you're gone.
Maybe the next day you're gone.
One day you're here, baby, and then you're gone.
The next day you're gone.
One day you're here, baby, and then you're gone.
This world we living in, man, it ain't nothing but trauma. Everyone wanna harm you. In New York, niggas getting shot for bombers. Now they got your life in the palm of their hand like California. Niggas with dubs are hydroponic. Marijuana, gangbanging got the ghetto hotter than a sauna. Down in Orange, my nigga Box died on the corner behind a funky ass dice game. I saw him once before we died, wish it was twice, man. I remember being 8 deep off in Chucky crib, letting us act bad, not giving a fuck what we did. When we lost him, I knew the world was coming to the end. And I had to quit letting that devil push me to a sin. My brother been in a bin for damn near 10. But now it look like when he come out, man, I'm going in.
Man. I perform that song in every show, but it's always different when you listen to it. I don't know, that's just me. I don't listen to myself. Like I do, and I do probably a good 150 shows a year and perform that song 150 times a year, but never really listen to it. There's a certain disconnect sometimes that you have as a performer. Like, you know it's your words, but it's kind of just like tying your shoes and shit. That's just what the fuck you do for a living. You know, if you work at McDonald's, you make a Big Mac, you don't think about it, you just fucking make the Big Mac. And that's what we do as rap. But when I listen to it, it's crazy because it still hits me the way it did when we wrote it. Like, when we made this record, we couldn't believe that it hit us like it did. Like, you know, it's a very personal record. It's a lot of very real shit on that song. And to hear it today is still crazy. You know, I just left Orange not too long ago. Riding through there, I was thinking about boxing. You know, I talk to my homeboy Bobo all the time, and he's remarried, and he's got, you know, he has a new baby girl now, and, you know, we still do these songs, and he still, you know, every now and then, you know, we get emotional on stage. We still cry when we hit his record because we're talking about people that we loved and lost. It's very real shit, and that's what music is supposed to be at its best. Now, don't get me wrong. At the very least, music should entertain people. People should be able to have a good time. But music at its best, when it's done at its best, should be able to inspire, enlighten people, and take them somewhere, you know? It's supposed to be a transcendental experience. It really is.
I think on like an emotional level, some of your songs are very strong. People can relate to it. And I think a part of that comes from you. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you're consciously trying to keep it simple somehow, you know? Like the flow and even some words, it's very, you know, direct, very straight and very appealing in a very, you know, straight way. Is that something you try to do consciously?
I know for Pimp's main thing was that he didn't really want to lose people with flows and styles. He's like, Bun B, you can do all that shit. You know, you the lyricist, you kick them crazy flows and shit. I'm gonna keep my shit sweet and simple. But for records like that, we tried to both keep it very simple because it was important that we get the message across to people. It wasn't about us showing off as lyricists and writers and all of that. It was about really getting the pure message across. And with a record like One Day, the whole point of it was that, you know, we know that everybody goes through loss. We all grieve, and it's painful for everybody. So why not let people know we're just like them? A lot of times in rap music particularly, people put up walls and they put up these pedestals, and soapboxes to preach to you and to look down on you like, yo, I'm the shit. You know what I'm saying? When really we should be like, yo, I'm the shit and you can be the shit too. That's the message that we're supposed to be getting across to people. Not that I made it, ha ha, look at you, you still broke. That's not what this shit is about. It's about everybody coming up. You know what I'm saying? So with us, we try to let people know like, yeah, we might be UGK, we sell records or whatever, wham, but when I lose a friend, it hurts me just like it hurts you. You know what I'm saying? When somebody goes to jail, it hurts me just like it hurts you, you know? Everything that we go through in life, and sometimes for us, it's a lot worse because I'll be out of town somewhere when somebody passes away and can't get back in time for the burial. That's happened to me at least 4 times. And, you know, one time in particular, my aunt passed away, and she was a woman that, you know, like when my mother used to have to work late, that's who I was going to stay with. And I couldn't even grasp the concept, the fact that she had died, because I hadn't gone to the funeral. You associate it with, you know, the past, and you go to the wake and the funeral, and you make your peace with it. But because I wasn't there, and I was removed from the situation, and hadn't seen my aunt, I would come home, like, after about a month, I'd be like, Mom, Aunt Jen is dead, right? She's like, yes, I just told you last month, yes, she's dead, accept it, deal with it, and move forward. But that's the thing, far gone in this music sometimes that you can lose sense of reality. So with us, we try to put as much reality into the music as possible so that it's always there and you always know who you are. You always know where your status is, you know?
But still, I mean, I think there's not one single rapper in the whole scene, industry, whatever, that doesn't respect you. And I think a lot of that comes from you being honest. Is that what you mean when you say reality?
Yeah, absolutely. I know, I remember the first time we went on a radio and told people that we were broke. And like, we didn't tell the radio station what we were doing. Like, yo, we want to come up and talk on the air today. They were like, all right, come on through. So we went up there like, so what's going on with UGK? Shit, UGK is broke. Excuse me? Yeah, man, we broke. The record company ain't paying us. We signed a fucked up deal. Shit is fucked up. And y'all bought all them records, and I didn't get a dime of it. So then people call up, be like, well, why y'all didn't get paid? Woo, woo, woo. So then we pull out the contract and start explaining to people on the air how fucked up our contract was. It gave the consumer an inside look into the shit. People didn't understand that type of shit. Like, well, you sold 500,000 records. Like, shouldn't you get a check from that? No, I can't get a check from that because the way my deal works, I don't get paid off of that. I get paid off of this. I only get paid from 7% of what the money is made, not from the 100% of the money. Like, wait a minute, whoa, whoa, whoa. So record companies people didn't know this type of thing. The consumer didn't know that shit about the game. We tried to expose as much as that shit as possible. One, for up and coming artists who might want to be us, it's important for you to know the game and have as much information as possible and know how these record companies will fuck over you. And for two, you can front for people all you want. Eventually, they will see who you are. If you keep talking about you got Benzes and Bentleys and you got all this money, eventually somebody's gonna see you get out of a car. And if it's not the Benz or the Bentley, you're gonna get confronted. Like, yo, Bun B, what's up? That's you jumping out the Hyundai? What the fuck you doing in a Hyundai? You say you was rolling Benz, or, you know, whoop, 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 and, you know, people see you shopping, people see you, you know, taking your kids to eat, going anything. You will get exposed. I don't care who you are and how good you think your lie is, it will catch up with you. This is the internet age with camera phones and there's a camera on every corner in most major cities. So whoever you really are, you talking about you got all the women in the world, but you really like men, you can front if you want to. We will eventually catch you with a boy. The reality is, nobody really cares who you fuck with. Nobody cares. We only mad because you lied. That's the whole thing. People be real about who they are and honest about who they are and let the people decide if they want to fuck with you or not. You'd be surprised. Be like, well, you know, I ain't got all that, I ain't got that, but I got talent. Hey, good enough for me, let's go. Most people don't really give a shit about that. You make good music, I can deal with it. You know what I'm saying?
But still, I mean, between telling truth and being real to where you come from and being this honest guy to selling out, I think that's like a big difference. Then there's a lot of compromises in there. So when the record label asks you to do this next Jay-Z record, okay, so maybe to explain that, you had the Jay-Z record, Big Pimpin', blew up on the national radio, whatever, made you famous other parts of the country. Right. So then they ask you for your next album to do one track with Timbaland and Jay-Z that was similar to the Big Pimpin' record. So how tempting was it back then to actually do it? Didn't even think about it like one time?
Not at all. Because, you know, for us, the exposure was good, but we knew it wasn't ours. Like, yeah, okay, this song is number one, but don't get the big head because this ain't your song. You know what I'm saying? You may have helped this song go number one, but we know who the fucking star is. Like, let's be real. You know, it's a Jay-Z record. It's the biggest shit on the fucking planet. Keep it very real. Don't get the big head. Get back in your little world. Because all that's going to happen is if I let them go get the Jay-Z verse, then they're going to pay $100,000 for that. If they go get the Timbaland beat, they're going to pay, at that time, they would have paid about $500,000 for that. Done the Hype Williams video, it'd been $500,000 for that. So already, just off one song, I'm $1.2 million in the hole. Now, do you want to be famous? Or do you want to actually make a fucking living out of your music? That's what a lot of artists have to come to terms with. Very few people get to be rich and famous. Doesn't really work like that. You either get to be rich, those are the people that kind of work behind the scenes, the producers, executive producers, people like that. Or you can be famous, the one in front of the camera doing all the singing and dancing. Everybody doesn't get to be Mick Jagger. We're not all gonna be filthy fucking rich and super fucking famous. So at the very least, maintain your integrity. You can make a living off of integrity.
So there's the money argument and there's the argument that a song with Jay-Z would have been your song, but still, it almost sounds like that if you would hear the song now, like the Big Pimpin' record, aren't you any proud of that? I mean, if you play it in a club nowadays, it still works, people still go crazy. Doesn't that make you proud at all?
Oh, no, it's not like I'm not proud of the music, but at the same time, it's not my song. You know what I'm saying? I can try to take as much claim for it as I can, but that shit says Jay-Z featuring UGK, not UGK and Jay-Z. It was his record. He asked us to be a part of it. We put it together. It ended up being a big thing. But then after that, you know, it's you know, he still gets to be superstar and I'm still here in my world. I did get a few more fans. Yes, I did, you know, increase my fan base a little bit. But still at the end of the day, if I go out of my way just to appease the new people who listen to me just because of Jay-Z, then I disrespect the 500,000 people who have been supporting me just because I'm me. And I'd rather have people like me for me than like me for anybody else. Fuck that. Like me for me. Because if you like me for Jay-Z, as soon as you stop liking Jay-Z, you stop liking me, right? So if you're going to fuck with me on my terms and my terms only. Or don't fuck with me at all. I'm still going to sleep at night. It's all good.
So I think we have a pretty good example here of a record with Jay-Z that is still very much a Bun B song or UGK song. Where is it here?
Smoke something, bitch. GK. Hold up. Talking about. P.A. Trill nigga, polo fuck that here figure. Made myself a ghetto star, on the slab sipping bar. Smoking weed, selling white, and mother nigga shit don't come back right. That's how niggas get popped, trying to get the cheaper price. Watch your paper guard your life, cause most of these niggas ain't living right. Keep your pistol, fuck a fight, cause niggas out here jack every night. I keep my mind on my money, nigga, fuck the fame. Big face hunters, deep in the game. Hitting the corner in the candy thing, sitting on leather, gripping the grain.
Yeah. Good weed, good drink, big money.
Hey.
Rolling in something foreign, no leather gripping drink.
Yeah.
I handle my business, so I think I deserve to
hey.
Go.
Hey.
Yeah.
When I came in the dope, I said it before. I never fuck a hoe without head no more. I never pull up with nothing less than a foe. And I smoke cigars, it ain't just for the show. I'm blessed from the dope, and known for my sit eye. I send a nigga baby by my home with a spit eye. You can have a bitch, nigga, I ain't send a minute. I smoke weed and freestyle, no instrument eye. Pin out, flip through the wicked streets of PA. Motherfuck the judge, prosecutor, and the DA. Head to the H where the hoes are fucked three-way, two-way, four-way. Anyway, the pro say, never hear a hoe say, no, I won't. No, I can't stop it, and no, I don't. Cause a bitch know I might just explode and slap in the face with a pie.
Yeah. Good weed, good drink, big money.
Hey.
Rolling in something foreign, no leather gripping.
Yeah.
I handle my business, so I think I deserve to.
Hey.
Good weed, good drink, big money.
Hey.
Rolling in something foreign, no leather gripping.
Yeah.
I handle my
y'all
business, so I think
nigga.
I deserve to.
Hey, 16-5 piece, hey. Scary, nigga, USDA.
No.
Hey.
I grind hard,
and play hard,
break out the pot,
yep.
Heat up the water,
damn.
Swear to God,
the minute Van do tricks,
hit the brakes, hit the lights,
and voila,
there go them bricks.
Yes,
the slide through the hood. Sitting on some big wheels.
Niggas
copping white, turn flips like cartwheels.
Trap star,
my next tail trip all day.
Day,
riding dirty, 3-9s and a 4-way.
Good weed, good drink, big money.
Hey.
Big money,
rolling
man.
In something foreign, no
we only ride the best.
I handle my business, so
big
I think
homie.
I deserve to.
Hey.
Try to told you I'm thug.
Hey.
Sun foreign, I'm torn on foreign land. Worldwide, I'm known for the arm and hand. Her the streets, I'm a wanted man. So it's on again. Started with the block, hit it brick by brick. Then I charted with the rock, nigga, hit by hit. I'm retarded with the Glock, nigga, clip by clip. The competition is none, they deceased to exist. Let it breathe a little bit. He's off his rocker, he's a little skit. Stole like a football, Hov used to cook raw. Now I got the game sold like Granny's good, sure. Y'all niggas want war, y'all got it backwards. Y'all shit want raw. Y'all shit want more.
Yeah.
Good weed, good drink, big money.
Hey.
Rolling in something.
Jay-Z.
So that's a song with Jay-Z. Jay's verse is in the end of the song.
Yeah.
When I listen to your music or just look at what you do in your moves and everything, sometimes it even looks like you do that stuff like consciously, you know? Like, you have the Jay-Z verse, but you put it in the end of the song. Just to show people, I can have the Jay-Z verse, but I can put it in the end if I want to. Is that true? Or
No.
Just the structure of the song?
You put the Jay-Z verse at the end of the song so that people listen to the whole record.
Yeah. That's what I meant, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Especially for a DJ, because otherwise a DJ, you know, they get the Jay-Z verse and then they on to the next record. So if you want the Jay-Z verse on here, you got to listen to the whole song. That's how you make sure. So anybody out there, if you get a big name feature, you spend a lot of money on them, put them at the end of the song. Because if you put them at the beginning when they play it on the radio, as soon as that person verse go off, they going to go to the next record. So be very careful with that. Spend your money and make sure people stay for the big show. You got to make them a big surprise at the end.
So that was a song of your solo album, Trill,
yeah.
Released in 2005, I think.
Yes.
In 2002, I guess, your partner, Pimp C, was incarcerated.
Yeah.
I mean, apart from the fact that whenever a good friend is incarcerated, it's always hard, but for you as a musician, as a group, what did that mean to you in that moment? What did you think when you heard he need to go to prison?
Well, I was in court when I was in the courtroom when he was sentenced. And my primary concern for one, you know, was for his kids. You know what I'm saying? As a father, as a provider for his family, like, how do you take care of your children while you're in prison? You know what I'm saying? So for me, that was my main concern. Like, how do I help this man continue to earn money? How do I make sure that his name still has weight when he comes home from prison so that he can continue to make music and provide for his family? And initially, we didn't know. You know, he had recorded some songs before he went in to try to put something out during the time, but he wasn't going to be available to actively promote the album, you know? So I was like, well, I'm going to have to make sure that I promote this album for him and try to get out there and support him the most I can. But we really had, there was no guidelines for that type of situation, rap-wise anyway. There had never been a situation where, you know, you take a two-man group and you take one of them out the group, like how does a group exist when it's an individual as opposed to a group? That's the meaning of a group, is more than one person. So how do you continue to exist? And for a while, we weren't really sure about how to keep it going. So, you know, I went and visited Pimp, you know, and we would talk about different things, and he was like, you know you're gonna have to make an album, right? I'm like, shit, I'm not making an album by myself. That's dead in the water. Like, man, you're gonna have to. Like, it's the only way. Like, because you still UGK. Like, just because I'm not on the street, you know, we still UGK. You know, people know we down with each other. You just gonna have to. The only way to keep the music going and keep the name alive is gonna be through you. And I had apprehensions about the shit myself because I didn't want people to think that once my man got locked up, fuck it, I'm on my own, I'm off doing my own thing. That's not how I operate. People know I'm a very loyal friend. So, you know, I was like, well, how can I make sure that whenever I'm doing music, people know that I'm still down with Pimp? That's where Free Pimp C came from. The whole Free Pimp C campaign was about whenever I did a feature on a verse on somebody's album or wherever I was, to make sure that I shouted Free Pimp C out. So there was always association with Bun B and Pimp C so that people would know not to get it twisted. Because, you know, for a lot of people, it's out of sight, out of mind. So my thing was, well, they can't see him, but they gonna hear him. They gonna hear his name constantly. Every time they hear me or see me, I'm gonna be saying his name. I'm gonna be wearing a fucking shirt with his picture or something. But I'm gonna fucking let them know that Pimp C is still here, you know?
So as far as loyalty at that point, was it even relevant to you, whatever he did or if he did it?
No, because at that point, when you love people, you don't really get to worrying about all that kind of thing. You know what I'm saying? It, and I know it sounds crazy, but, like, you know, if you have, like, say, if your brother kills somebody, like, you're going to look at your brother real fucked up, like, damn, you a murderer. That's fucked up. Like, you a terrible dude. We used to play football in the backyard. That's, I know you want to kill somebody. You know, not saying Pimp C kills somebody, but I'm just making a point. But that doesn't mean you instantly stop loving this person. You may not like them much at all, but it's still your blood, it's still your kin, it's still your family. It's not easy to write people off sometimes, you know what I'm saying? And my whole thing was, you know what, you know, you made a mistake, you know, who's to say that I won't make a mistake? So I can't sit here and really just judge you like that, you know? But, you know, I'm gonna ride with you, you know what I'm saying? Like, cause shit, I rode with you before, you know, in the good times, when we was making money and riding around and having all the kind of fun, it was all good. But now that you're going through a rough spot, you know what I'm saying, I'm not just gonna write you off like that. I just can't do that. It's just not in my nature.
I mean, I think Pimp's case is in a way very special, a lot of maybe, yeah, wrong circumstances, whatever, but don't you think it's kind of often overlooked in hip hop whenever there's these free somebody campaigns going on that those people are actually criminals sometimes?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, and like I say, sometimes people, they just don't care. You know what I'm saying? It's just, of course he's a criminal, but he's in prison. He's paying his debt to society. You know what I'm saying? So we're not saying just open up the doors and let him out. We know that's not possible. You know what I'm saying? But it's more just a reminder. It's like, hey, you know, let my man go. You know what I'm saying? I know at some point he's going to come up for parole or probation and get a man a chance. You know what I'm saying? It's you know, we know that when we start a free somebody campaign, that a lot of times the person may not be freed. But sometimes, you know, you have to fight a fight you can't win just to let people know that you are willing to fight, you know?
So at that point, when you started, you know, yeah, when you started your solo career and becoming this feature machine, Bun B, who's on everybody's song and does his solo albums and that kind of stuff, at that point, were you sure you could win this fight, or was it a fight that you just started to show everybody you are willing to fight?
I wasn't sure. I didn't, you know, I felt like I was in one of the greatest groups of all time. I never wanted to be a solo artist. You know, I was very comfortable working with Pimp, you know what I'm saying, as a group. I had no intentions on wanting to go off and do my own thing, you know what I'm saying? I was very comfortable where I was. But sometimes life takes you out of your comfort zone and shows you who you really are and what you're made of. Had I sat in a group situation that long, you know what I'm saying, you know, it's no telling if I would have been able to just make a conscious decision to just go ahead and try a solo career. My solo career came basically out of necessity. The fact that it was the best way that I could bring, you know, keep the UGK name going. So for me to make a solo album, a lot of it was really getting started. You know, once I actually made a decision that, okay, I'm gonna do this, because I probably spent 18 months just sitting around like, what the fuck, man, I can't do this. Like, I don't wanna do this. You know what I'm saying? I don't wanna make a solo album because, again, I don't want people thinking I'm thinking about myself. Where, honestly, you know, and I've talked to people about it, and people have been like, you know what, man, if you would have wanted to go on with yourself, we totally would have understood. Dude caught his case, he went to prison, whatever you had to do to keep yourself going, you know, people would have understood if I would have decided to go off on my own. But it wasn't about that, you know what I'm saying? And where I'm from, loyalty is the key, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, in small towns, sometimes all you got are your fucking friends, you know? And I know that for a fact, had I been in his position, he would have done exactly what I did, and maybe even more. And sometimes, you know, you have to make sure that you do for people what they would do for you. At least that's how I feel.
Did you talk to him about it? Like, when you consciously started to working on this album, did you talk to him?
Yeah. I would go and see him and send different letters and talk about different stuff. And, you know, Pimp had input. Pimp was like, you know, you got to talk about them broads, man. And I was like, man, that's your thing. Like, I don't really do that. You do those songs. He said, well, go get niggas that's doing the best songs about girls right now. It's not like they're not going to want to work with you, you know? So I went and got Yin Yang Twins. They was making all the best booty records at the time. So I'm like, yo, let's make a booty record, you know? They're like, hell yeah.
Like, the solo album, like, there was a totally different approach, I think, to what you did with UGK. UGK always had its sound, had its topics, had its style. And now with the solo record, you featured pretty much everybody. And there was a whole lot of different records. Was that intentionally?
Yeah, for me, doing a solo album was not so much about getting my own personal views of the world out there. It was really about trying to touch as many people as I could. And I've gotten flack for that because people, you know, people say, well, you didn't need to make the song with Trey Songz and Mike Jones and Birdman on it for the ladies. I'm like, well, I did because I needed to get my message to Trey Songz fans and Birdman's fans and Mike Jones fans. Same thing with the Yin Yang Twins. I needed to get my message out to all these people's individual fan bases, you know, Free Pimp C, UGK for life. It was important that as many people as I could get to hear that. That's why I ended up on so many albums, because I basically said, look, anybody that's working, let me know. You know what I'm saying? I'm open, and you know, because I really want to get this message out. And then I would have people call me, be like, you know, like they would call and say, yo, like Ludacris is like, yo, Bun, I know what you're trying to do right now. If you need me for something, let me know. Same thing with T.I., Bun, if you need me right now for something, let me know. And then other people, you know, and even the T.I. would say, and come get on my album. You know what I'm saying? That way you can really get in touch with my fan base. So a lot of that was really people offering themselves to the project. When, you know, I had so many guest features because I had so many people wanting to help me keep the UGK name alive. Like, there's probably 3 or 4 songs that we didn't even use. It was like, you know what? I think we got like 18 features on here. Like, this might be too much. It's almost a fucking compilation album now, you know? But that's just a testament to the love that people have for Pimp C as well as UGK.
But how did it feel like when you recorded the album, when you listened to it now? You stressed like 25 times before that you really not about touching as many people as possible or thinking in, like, I don't know, target groups. But now you actually did that, and that was a good reason to do it. But still, how did it feel?
Oh, man, I can't even lie. I was numb through a lot of it. I really, I had a real bad drinking issue at the time, because that's the way I choose to deal with the fact that my best friend was locked up and maybe my career, my life was going down the drain. I hit the bottle. And it probably was one of the lowest points of my life, like literally. Like, I'm ashamed to look, when I look back and I talk with my wife and friends about, you know, how bad I was. Like, you're looking at a person that probably was drinking almost a fifth of Hennessy a day, trying to drown myself in the pain. But then every morning I would wake up and the pain would still be there. So there you go, trying to numb that shit again. Till finally, you know, you have to make a decision to fucking deal with it and get over it, because obviously the liquor ain't helping. The problem is still here. You know, you can take the pills, you can take the drugs, you can do whatever you want, but eventually when the cloud leaves, the problem is still there. And it's harder to keep that cloud in front of you. So with me, you know, I said, you know, drinking was a big problem, and really just, you know, I had to really just get out of feeling sorry for my fucking self. There's really no other way to say it. I was like, man, you know, Pimp is gone, the group is over, and all this shit, oh, man. You know, my wife was like, okay, well, get the fuck up and do whatever it is you got to do. You know, you can't be playing here. Life still goes on. And, you know, I sucked it up. I got in the studio. I surrounded myself with people I knew I could trust. You know what I'm saying? My manager, Red, and, you know, I've recorded with people like Corey and Mike and, you know, people that I knew had my back and people like N.O. Joe, who I knew would tell me that's not jamming. Because that was my main thing, was that if I'm going to do an album and Pimp's not here, because Pimp was the person with the ear that knew what songs was hitting and what wasn't, I need people whose opinions I can fucking trust. I don't need somebody to just be like, sit there in the studio, man, that shit jamming, that's what I'm talking about. I need somebody to be like, that shit all right, but that's not the real. Like, you need to do some of that shit. You know what I'm saying? People who ain't scared to tell me, come out the booth, just come out. Just get the fuck out of there. That was terrible. Get out, type of situation, which don't happen that often because I'm pretty good right now. But at a time, you know what I'm saying, I was very unsure about the shit, and I needed people, honest people that I knew would give me the right information and, you know, hold me down the right way.
So when the record came out, it was this big time for Houston or Texas rap, like the Mike Jones and even Chameleon started and like Paul Wall and everything, Mike Jones thing got big. So could you, how did that feel for you? Like the success that was definitely there, even with your solo album, like it was released independently, sold crazy units. Like it was really a big success for you at that point, and maybe a success that nobody really did expect. So could you even be happy at that time? Looking at the rap scene, what was going on?
Happy, I wouldn't say happy. You know what I'm saying? I felt like the mission was accomplished. You know what I'm saying? But it's bittersweet, you know what I'm saying, which we've had a lot of that, you know, lately with the UGK legacy. It's hard to celebrate when the person that you usually celebrate this shit with isn't there to celebrate it, you know? And my whole thing was trying to get him the album so he could hear it, you know what I'm saying? Like, how the fuck do I get him this album in prison so he could hear it? And I can't get into how he got it, but he did eventually get the album. I'm not gonna snitch or no shit like that. But he did get the album, and he did listen to it, man, and shit, he was proud of what I did. And that was really all the confirmation I needed, you know what I'm saying? Believe me, I appreciated the sales and the support and the radio play and all of that, but at the end of the day, I just wanted to make sure that I did my homeboy proud. And if I did that, then I knew we would be selling records.
Okay. But still, there's this one remix on there, like the Draped Up remix with all the Houston rappers on it. It's like, when you look at it, it's just a regular posse cut, like all the Houston rappers, everybody doing their thing, like mixtape rapping, everybody just spitting bars and representing the city and whatever. It's nothing special, but you really can hear the pride in that. Is that true? Was it pride most of all?
Yeah, because my whole thing was, you know, it's called the H-Town mix. And my thing was like, you know what, man, you know, Paul, you doing it, Mike, you doing it, Slim, you doing it, Ro, you coming up right now, you know what I'm saying? We need to show them this united front. We need to show them that all of us are here, we're doing it big, and we're gonna be here for a while. And it's, everybody can't do that. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like Slim can call Paul or Mike and Kuba, but maybe he can't call, you know, two or three other people. Like everybody can't get everybody. I understand I have a certain position in the game where people look up to me. So if I call on somebody to do something for me, it's not just cause I can. You know what I'm saying? I call them because I have a deeper purpose in mind. And I know that just because we have the light now doesn't mean it's going to stay there. And the best way to keep the movement going was to show a united front because there's strength in numbers. And that's what we tried to do on the remix.
Big 12 of Texas, it's where legends are born. I'm Lil Kiki the Don, original screwed up click. It's a dedication to DJ Screw, Fat Pack, Big Mello, Big Steve.
Draped up and dripped that, no how bad. Draped up and dripped that, no how draped up and dripped that, no how bad. Draped up and dripped that, no how draped.
I'm draped up and dripped out, the truth done just slipped out. 84s, red O's, candy apple flip flop. Got them boppers tripped out, cause my drop tip top. Purple trucks screw us up, that's what keep the streets hot. Don T, Bun B, please free Pimp C. Hydro, super flow, know these boys feeling me. Come to Houston, Texas, and see swaggers and lax. And don't forget to tell the people that them legends are back. Yeah.
It's Slim Thug showing H-Town love. Used to hit the club on dubs, acting bad on scrub. Man, spokes and leather, 24s are better. Boys say they riding candy, but my load is wetter. The road's full competitors when they see the two letters. They'll never, ever, ever, ever get on my level. Me and Bun together, caked up with clout. Staying draped up and dripped out, know what I'm talking about.
The city is back, just look at the map, thought we wouldn't get in the game. I'm sticking my jig up in the game and busting in that like a train. I'm hitting that main, look at this grain, I'm gripping, I'm fixing the swing. My bumper doing the body rock and my trunk is doing the crane. Now who in the hell was able to tell the world it wasn't my bang? I turn up the beat, I'm cracking the street, the city just started to drain. The world is looking like Texas, man, just watch how they pick up the slang. Just show them your grill and pick up some drink and watch how they do the same. Hold up, man.
Baby, it's pow wow. Players rise while haters fall. Got folks crawling in the 50 foul on the service road. I'm evading the laws. I stay shining like headlights and I stay crowding like headlights. Just like a barber, I fade the dice. Them twos and threes ain't nothing nice. Them threes and fours, I'm a rope for show. Well, both and both, we call them swing. My partner Bun B, bring the pain. Wanna know what I rep? Just check the chain. In the hood, is where I hang. On South bleed at 5'9. We sipping oil and we dripping candy. PA to H-Time, it go down.
Draped up and
tripped
out. No, how
about
draped up and tripped out.
I say draped up, drip that. Drop the top when I'm flipping that. Candy load on 84, you know they fold. They broken that. Ice agent rap a lot, flipping hoes in the parking lot. Ice agent rap a lot, flipping hoes in the parking lot. Diamonds shining in my grill, you can see them if it's dark at night. When I'm out in the limelight, I make sure I shine bright. I'm in the drop with the Glock cock, you know I keep that iron tight. I'm getting brain from a tight dame, no knock man in the turning lane. I'm nothing rich, talk a lot of shit, I guess because I'm having things.
You steal trade trucks and dripped out, know what I'm talking about. Fighting over parking spots, busting in the parking lot. Two sabres, vatos, raised off tacos, parce, te mato sin ningún contrato. Vamos, now put your blocks up, now put your sets up. And fuck that nigga over there, cause I think he says go. Pass that word clip out, with a click out, don't give a shit about till he gets out. Keep Pimp C, we draped up and dripped out.
Hey, I told Bun, when you need a verse, just holler. You know how we do it, you ain't gotta spend no dollars. I'm fucking broke, banging screwed and riding balls. Middle fingers in the air, you know how it goes. Stash by, we wait in it, candy paint with flakes in it. Trunk got the bass in it, 1 liters with eights in it. Swishers we with haze in it, you know I'm blow. Four row, diamond chain, you know I'm pro. Shunny got me right, huh, 80 carats bright, huh. Hit the button, pop the trunk, watch the neon light chunk. I'ma keep rolling brand, tell Pimp, hold his head. We miss you, DJ Screw, man, I hate you.
Y'all can ride red, but I'ma ride blue in the turning lane, looking just like Screw. 300 crimpy on day they dope. Everybody know zero flow is ferocious. I keep a ride with Davis in the deck. My deep blue 22 drink in the wet. You can keep the shirt, but you can pass the cup. It's my Cadillac rolling on glass and wood. If I knock a jacket down with his ass, get up. Hell nah, that's a split from the chest to the nuts. When Screw is living, he said he bet I come up. Now the radio station requesting my stuff. Gotta keep a Smith and Wesson in the bus. Cause a better life keep me stressing enough. This rap for real, is it a blessing or what? Screw you, I see you when they wake me up.
This is
A-Town,
Texas. Tell me, how does it look? Taking over the rap kitchen and we ready to cook. You can hear us whipping the peakers coming out of the speakers. Shipping up some fresh hard for you out of town geekers. We got third board, fourth board, and south side keys. Plus southwestern blooded nickel rolling 83s. It's Bruce in Texas, motherfucker, you know the name. And we'll see you in February for the all-star game.
Wow. I don't even know the last time I heard that shit. And we'll see you in February for the All-Star game. Wow, that's crazy. That was a big record. Now that I really listen to, I'm really remembering like when we did drop it. It was to us, you know, we put it together like we're gonna make a nice little posse cut, but the city was really, really fucking proud of that record. Like Houston was really like, man, that's how we always need to look. You know what I'm saying? We've been trying hard to look like that ever since, but you know, people are people. Nobody's perfect, you know?
So from an outside perspective, it was like those 2 years where Houston was really big. It was all about Houston, all those big records. It was really interesting, like to see the different styles and the music and everything, but suddenly everybody disappeared. Is that something you agree on, like from a Houston perspective or a Texan perspective?
Well, I wouldn't say disappeared. I think just the amount of music that people were putting out. You gotta understand the reason that Slim Thug and Paul and Mike and Chameleon and them rose to the fame that they did was because of the musical output. It's no, you know, it's when you look and see all these people that seem like they just blown up out of nowhere, it's no coincidence when 50 Cent blew up, it was because 50 Cent was making the most music. He was putting out the most music in mixtapes. Same thing with the Dipset. When the Dipset rose to its prominence, it's because they were making the most music. And that's what it's really about, man, about putting product out for the people. You know, as the years have gone by and people have, you know, gotten more and more into the musical experience and not just listening, but actually understanding the process of music being recorded, people realize now that it doesn't really take a lot of time to make a song, per se. And there's so many songs that you could be putting out for free. Like, for example, anybody that wants to rap to a Beatles record, don't even consider putting it out for sale, because it's not going to happen. You'll never clear it. It'll never fucking happen in a million years. But that doesn't mean you can't make a great song out of a Beatles record and just give it to the people. You know what I'm saying? All those samples that you know won't clear, that's the perfect way to get your name in the game, because usually when a song doesn't clear, it's because the song is big and the people are real fucking famous and they don't want you fucking with their shit like that, because it's a lot to be gained from it. So that's the best thing to do, is to take these big ass records. You can't make any money off of it, but that doesn't mean that you can't get it to people and people can't like it, listen to it, jam it, and appreciate it and you. You know what I'm saying? You look back 2 years ago, the number one album was the Clips mixtape. You know what I'm saying? It was music that they couldn't put out, but it was still good music that they made. And at the end of the day, that's really what this is about. You know what I'm saying? Like, none of us are really promised to just get filthy fucking rich off of this music shit, but we should at least be trying to have fun with it. Now, who the fuck wants to sit around in the studio with a serious motherfucker all the time? Just serious and broke and frustrated. I'm broke and frustrated. I don't mean I gotta be fucking down all the time. That's the whole point of making this music, is to have fun, to lift yourself up, to lift your spirits, and hopefully lift other people's spirits too. We shouldn't all be like making Philip Glass music, depressing the shit out of everybody.
So when...
You know Bun B know about Philip Glass, dude.
So when Pimp came out of prison then in 2005, at the end, yeah, by the end of the year, I think.
Right.
Going from a situation where it really seemed like it could be the end of the group to a situation where the group was maybe stronger than ever before, what was your state of mind when you restarted working on the next record?
We were just happy, like, all bullshit aside. It was just, we were just ready to make music together and do what we had been doing for so long. You know, Pimp was a person who I know personally since he was about 14 years old, got up every morning and made music, literally. So when you do that for half your life and then one day you wake up and you can't make any music at all, it'll fuck with your mind. Like, if you could do anything every day and then all of a sudden they tell you can't do it, like if your favorite food is potatoes and you've been eating potatoes every day and tomorrow you wake up and they'll be like, oh yeah, there's no more potatoes. Like, it's just mad potato disease. You ain't here? They had to kill all the potatoes. Like, there's no more potatoes. We can't eat potatoes ever again. That'll fuck your head up, because there's really no replacement for potatoes if you like potatoes. You can't eat cauliflower and eggplant just because it's white and mushy. That shit ain't a potato. I just figured that out in the hall at the buffet. So, you know, at that time, we were just, you know what, man? I'm just so fucking happy that you home. He was like, man, me too. I just want to make this music again. We went in the studio. He was trying to go to the studio the day he got out of jail. I was like, no. You need to go take a bath. You need a good fucking meal. You need to kiss your kids and your wife. Spend time with your family. Studio's gonna be here. It's not going nowhere. He was like, shit. It just went somewhere for 4 fucking years. I was like, wow, touche. My bad. I said, but no, seriously, give yourself a day or two. You know what I'm saying? He got in, and the first song we did when he came home was the Get Throat remix that he rapped on. And you know, we sat there and we cut the beat on, we kind of looked at each other. And one thing about Pimp and I, we write our rhymes in the same room, but without talking to each other. Like, he'll be on one sofa, I'll be on another sofa, and the beat will play, and we'll write our rhymes, but we won't say anything about the rhymes until after it's written. But it's always meshed. We didn't understand that shit. Just like, you do you, I do me. For some reason, that shit always made sense together. And that was the one thing we wanted, like, you know, he's been in prison for 4 years, like, can we still do that? We sat down, cut on the beat, he wrote his rhyme, I wrote mine, he laid his, I laid mine. It made perfect sense in the world. We looked at each other like, psh, let's go. And we just kept making music. That's why the UGK album ended up being a double album, We really made about 35, 40 songs for the album because we just was just on a roll and it was just feeling so good and it was right. You know what I'm saying? It was so right. It made all the sense in the world that me and this dude were supposed to make music together. Like, there's no way around that shit. When he came home from prison, it's something that we really both started really understanding a lot clearer. Not just that we make good music together, but it's that we were meant to make this music together. And at that point, we was like, you know what? Let's just fucking make it. Let's just keep making it. Whatever goes, goes. Whatever doesn't, doesn't. But let's just make music. Because at the end of the day, that's what we're supposed to be doing together.
Okay, so I understand it worked out well from the first day after he came out of prison. But was it any different from it was before?
No, not at all. That's what, and that's the funny thing. That's what we were worried about. Like, is it going to be different? And once we did that first round, we knew it wasn't going to be different. In fact, it was going to be even better because we were going to appreciate it more. You know what I'm saying? We knew now what every song that we did together meant, not just to us, but to other people. You know, we had a much better understanding of our history, of our legacy, of our reputation, and of our fan base as well. And it was just, you know what? We know everything we need to know about this group. We know everything we need to know about making the music that this group makes and our connection to the people. So let's just fucking do it. You know, the record company was like, yes, please do you. We don't want anybody on this album. Like, no, we're going to put features on the album. I was like, well, whatever. Let's just give the people UGK. And by that point, everybody understood what it was, you know?
And like person-wise, like as a musician, he didn't change in those 5 years, you said, but like as a person, did you notice any difference when he came out?
No, just more of an intensity. You know, we would talk, I would go and see him and I'd be like, so you've been writing in here? He's like, man, what you talking about? I've been writing in here. Like, I got about 400 songs. I'm like, wow. I was like, so what do you do with beats? I was like, cause like I said, when you're a producer, you constantly have these songs in your head. And I asked him, I'm like, what do you do with all these beats that are in your head? He was like, I write them out. I was like, how do you write a beat out? He's like, man, I just think of, you know, what the drum pattern would be. And, you know, I make notes to myself. He said, it's not something that you could read, Bun B, and understand. But it's some shit that I could look at and realize, oh, yeah, that was this song. And, you know, just by saying it was, you know, with this bass line. And if you say, trust me, I know what the fuck I'm saying. He said, you know, he said, I knew just how to, you know, put that shit down on paper to a point where I could look at it and be like, yeah, I'm still making music. He said, all the songs that he made and all the different samples and shit, he's like, nobody ever made them. Like, he would have ideas for songs and samples. He was like, in the 4 years he was gone, nobody did them. So he was able to come back home and put those same songs out that he had envisioned in prison.
So you said before that whenever you started working on an album together, you always tried to put together a concept or maybe an overall style for the album. So how would you describe the double album, the Underground Kingz?
The double album, well, first off, it was the first album that we did. It's kind of crazy because we waited 5 albums to do a self-titled album. But we did that because the name of the group, Underground Kingz, summed up everything that we had gone through. No one was supposed to be able to come home after 4 years and still have a career. No one man was supposed to be able to keep a group alive. You know what I'm saying? Who goes to prison and comes back bigger? It doesn't work like that. You know what I'm saying? So against all the odds and obstacles and shit that people put up in our way, we surpassed it. We went past the points that everyone said we would end up stopping at. When Pimp got locked up, people said that was it. You know, when that was gonna be the end of that. It was like, y'all ain't gonna be nothing again. Then I kept doing features like, yeah, but still you ain't finna have a career. Then I did a solo album. They were like, well, yeah, you got a little career, but it still ain't gonna be UGK. And then he came home and we were still UGK. Every time they said we were gonna fail, we achieved, we succeeded. And that's because we are the Underground Kingz. Every time somebody thinks they know who we are, we prove them wrong. Every time somebody thinks they have us locked into a spot, we move past that spot. And it's because we care more than they hate.
So the underground, is that what you mean by that when you call yourself an underground king nowadays? I mean, obviously you're not underground in a classic sense or whatever, in a narrow sense, but
right.
Is that what you mean by that? Like, standing up?
Yeah, just a matter of, you know, even though I'm, you know, like you say, you know, we wouldn't be considered underground, but we still rep for the underground, and we are here as an example as how far an underground artist can go. So just getting into the game doesn't mean, you know, there's so many levels to success within this music industry that you can achieve to. I still haven't made a platinum album. You know, and there are people who come out their first time, you know what I'm saying, that many people probably don't even like what they do, and they go platinum 2-3 times platinum. So there's still levels of success that this group was still trying to achieve. So for us, you know, we're still the underdogs. Like, for example, I use Jermaine Dupri as an example of where I'm trying to go in life a lot, because Jermaine Dupri is my age, but Jermaine Dupri is worth probably 50 times as much, well, no, probably about 100 times more than I am, because I'm not doing it like that. He's really, really fucking rich, but he's my age, and I keep thinking to myself, what the fuck am I not doing? You know what I'm saying? Am I not working hard enough? It's not so much as equating myself successfully with him. It's just a matter of thinking, as much as I think I'm doing, there's somebody who's been here no longer than me, but has managed to get further than me. So maybe I should still be trying a little harder. You know what I'm saying? You can never, no matter who you are and where you are in life, think that you got it, because just when you think you got it, somebody will walk right past you with it, wearing it, swagged out, and you be like, God damn, he got it. And then you're forced with a choice of, do I hate on him or do I go do my thing? And you know, I think the answer is obvious.
The number, like having a number one album, did that mean anything to you? Like we, our generation, I think a lot of people grew up with listening to chart shows on the radio, and it was always about this, oh, who's number one? It was very important, yeah. Was it like that with you as well?
At that point, yeah. Because, you know, we started understanding the game a little bit better. We started to understand that, you know what? There's enough people that fuck with UGK that if this record drops on the right day and say, you know, Mariah Carey or Celine Dion or you know, Tim McGraw, somebody that usually sells 5 or 6 fucking thousand albums the first week, if nobody like that comes out, we may actually have a shot at having the number one album in the country. And for us, once again, being from Port Arthur, Texas, little bitty ass town, it would have meant the world to, you know, to them, because a lot of times, you know, when you're an entertainer, or, you know, a person of influence or whatever it may be, lots of people tend to live their lives vicariously through you. And they take their success through your success. So it's kind of like with us being from Port Arthur, when another kid from Port Arthur sees us, it's like, if UGK can do that, then I can too. And that kind of shit is important. So for us to be able to have the number one album in the country coming from where we're from, it meant everything, because it's just that much more inspiration to a lot of people who don't really have a lot to be inspired by. And I think that's really what, at the core of UGK, what we were trying to get across, is to inspire the uninspired, you know? Like, man, I know it's fucked up where you at, I know it's not a lot going on, but if you really want to have something in life, you can have it. Right there in that little last town, you can have it.
So if the Underground Kingz record represents something like the essence of the group, so to say, do you think?
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you think there's one song on there that represents the essence as well? The one essential tune of that record?
On the Underground Kingz album? There's a several, like, because this was an album that we really was like, you know what? We're not leaving nothing out on this album. We want to talk about family. We want to talk about, you know, relationships. We want to talk about religion. We want to talk about the way we look at the world. We want to talk about the way the world looks at us. And we want to be very, very real about the shit. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of songs represent that. Songs like Living My Life, you know what I'm saying, represents that. I mean, Live This Life represents that. Lord, I'm Just a G. You know what I'm saying? Things that a lot of people who are, you know, in the streets and doing some, you know, different type of shit, they think about a lot of things. Like, if you're a criminal and you live your life doing criminal shit, then, you know, late at night when you're at home, you wonder how God looks at you. You wonder if, you know, you've done so much wrong, will God forgive you and let you into heaven? You know what I'm saying? Even though you know you're a good person, but you've done a lot of bad shit. But if you really know how it works, you know, God forgives everybody for everything regardless, and you still looking at life as the way man won't forgive you, but God always forgives. But that's the kind of shit that we know young cats in the streets have issues with, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm trying to do this, and I know it's wrong, but I'm doing it because it seems like it's the only thing I can do, and will people forgive me when this is over? So it's a lot of shit like that. We did a record with Ronald Isley that didn't make this album that I felt represented everything that had to be said about UGK, but it'll be on the next album that's getting ready to come out.
Do you have it with you? Do you have it on your phone?
Do I have that with me? No. Is Corey in here? Corey must have stepped out. My engineer is with me, but he might have that shit. Even though he won't admit it, he probably got all that shit in his computer listening to that shit at night when I tell him leave that shit at the studio. I know you just be sitting around, man, you want to hear some shit? Because we all love music. There's no way anybody in here, when they get their hands on some new music, cannot not play it for somebody. You got to. So I know he got some of that shit. He just ain't going to tell me because he know not to play that shit in front of me. But on the Underground Kingz album, I don't know, man. Probably The Game Belongs to Me.
Thank you.
Because that's how we felt, and that's how I still feel. Oh, he got all that shit in there.
Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me. I got Bobby by the con, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me. I got Bobby by the con, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me. I got Bobby by the con, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me.
I got money on my people, dead trees on my phone. They call me Mick Jagger cause I wrote a lot of stone. It's a whole lot of clone, but only one Sweet Jones. Turning horse to carnivore, they just can't leave my meat alone. It's been a long time since I hustled on the block, but every corner that I hit, I left it screwed up and shot. Marooned up and dropped like my wrist on top. Left the motherfucker bleeding till it dripped the lead drop. I'm still that young boy that had a pocket full of stone, but now it's 6 for 60 big, gripping wood and flipping chrome. I got Bobby by the pine, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me.
I got Bobby by the pine, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me. I got Bobby by the pine, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me. By the pine, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me. I got Bobby by the pine, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me.
Man, I pull up in your city and get my push on.
What is that?
Lay down the competition, take they cash crops and get my push on. Moved up to Bentley, remote from a Lexus key. All because we cornered the market on that Texas tea. And we don't want no clicks, cause we way bigger than other minnows. Diamond deuces, out tinted windows, we in the window. Whichever way the wind blow, that's the corner we been, Joe. Don't know where you been, bro, but it's no wins with me, you win, no. And it's 10-4, good buddy, my styrofoam good and muddy, we block bleeders. Even your neighborhood's good and bloody, we gripping that woodland, buddy. Damn. Sit back and scope it. Pay attention, the prints are pushing, everything's about to pump it.
I got Bobby by the pine, Whitney by the key, DJ Screw by the gallon, bitch, the game belong to me.
That should be crazy to listen to, man. Like I might be in a minority, but I don't know about many. I don't listen to myself. That's just me. I don't. Does anybody around here listen to the music you make? Like just ride around listening to yourself? I mean, I'm not talking about when you're making it and you put in, you want to hear how it sounds and maybe play it for somebody else to get an opinion. But I just can't sit around and listen to myself. And I've been with people, I won't name names, that's what they do. They get in their car, they put their CD in, turn that shit up, put the windows down, lean out the window. Like it's me riding, you hear me rapping. I'm like, Jesus Christ, you really like you, don't you? You really, I hope other people like you, because it seems real important.
So why is it you don't listen to your own music? Because it's not interesting for you? Because it bores you? Or is it more like you don't like your voice? Or why is that?
I'm not into me like that.
Really? But the game belongs to you.
Yeah, so it's no, I don't sit around like, reminding myself. I know what it is. I'm cool. And then I'm still a fan of music. more than an artist. I will always consider myself a fan of music more so than just an artist, because I listen to music more than I record music. That's just me personally. I'm always listening to whatever the new shit is, or if I can't find some new shit I like, then I start playing the old shit again. But not me. I'm not too keen on me. It seems a little facetious to me to sit around and listen to you fuck yourself all day, you know? Like, really? That's what you do? Why don't you just carry a mirror around and look at yourself all day too?
So talking about new shit, I think what really sets you apart from some other rappers that have your status is that you still work or always work with people who might not have that much of a big name or big budget or whatever. Like on the Underground Kingz record, there's a Dizzee Rascal song, and you were featured on his album as well as UGK. Then, I don't know, recently you did something for Kids in the Hall, Wale, whatever. Is that important for you to actually help people getting on and being some sort of, I don't know, sometimes it even feels to you some sort of legitimizer, you know what I mean? Like you hop on people's records and from then on it's okay, he has Bun on his record, he has to be good. Like, is that of any importance for you to actually help the people starting their career, or is it more like, I really like them as artists, I want to work with them for me because I like them, I want
to
do it?
It's a little bit of both, you know what I'm saying? I listen to a lot of music, and you know when somebody's got it. You can listen to these cats and be like, yo, this kid is hot. Like, seriously, this boy is bad. He's a real fucking good artist. And I hope that the game don't fuck him up, because that's what happens to a lot of young talented people, is that the game will use you up and spit you out or frustrate you the way you don't even want to be a part of the shit. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of times as an artist, there's nobody to talk to because nobody really understands your situation. You know, you can't go to your friends that don't make music and tell them, man, I got these music and I just want to get it out. I just got to get it out. And they'll tell you some shit. Well, just put the shit out. What the fuck, man? You don't understand. I need to get this out to the people. I need them to feel this. I need them to hear this and see this. And a lot of times you don't have people to talk to about that shit. And, you know, me, you know, if it wasn't for like a Too Short or E-40 or J Prince, man, I don't know where I would be today. If it wasn't for these people taking the time to listen to me fucking complain about different shit and help me try to work different things out, I wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't have a career today. So for me, I felt it was only right to be that person for people that Too Short and E-40 were for me. You know what I'm saying? So if I hear Cat and he's talented and different things, I'll call him and I'll let him know whenever you start going through some shit, because you're going to go through some shit. Give me a call, you know what I'm saying? A lot of times, like right now, because I've been with my wife for 10 years, we've been married for 5. So most of the young rappers, when they start getting ready to get engaged or they get married, they pretty much call me because they want to know, like, how do you balance a career with the family? When money gets fucked up and contracts ain't right, they call me because they know I've had a fucked up contract, but I'll be able to work above that. That's why we try to be honest with people, so that when people have the same problems that we had, they have somebody that they can try to come to. And, you know, with me, some people I just call and tell them, look, man, you're going through some shit, right? I know what you're going through. I know what happened. You fell out with your management. You went over here. They fuck, whoop, whoop, whoop. And they be like, man, how you know all this? Because like, it happened to me twice. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's no big deal. You're going to get over this. But a lot of times when you in the shit, you can't see past it. You know what I'm saying? Like they say, you can't see the forest for the trees. And it's important to call a Killer Mike, you know, or to call a Wale and call him and tell him, look, man, just keep your head up, G. You know what I'm saying? And if you don't understand some shit, just call me. I try to talk you through it the best way I can.
So this whole inspiring other artists or helping them or leading the way or whatever, is that the main reason why it's still UGK for life even after Pimp C's death? I mean, I cannot even imagine how it feels like if your partner in a group dies after all you made through together and whatever. Is that like the main reason that you really want to keep up the group's name and keep doing what you're doing just to show other people the way and tell them it's possible?
Well, my thing is that, you know, you can tell people all you want. You can talk till your mouth run dry, till your tongue fall the fuck out. But it's only until they see you actually doing what you say that they really understand what you mean or give you credit for it. So for me, I could talk all day, but I'd rather lead by example and prove the point by action. So, you know, my integrity, I try to keep as out front as possible, because I tell every artist that if you have no integrity, you have nothing. Your money will leave, your fans will leave, your fame, your career, everything will leave if it's not built on integrity. You know what I'm saying? That's the foundation for every artist. You know what I'm saying? Whatever you're true to, be true to that. And with UGK for life, it's UGK in the last few years, especially after Pimp, you know, went to prison and came home, we both came to the understanding that UGK is bigger than just the two men in the group. And it means a lot to people. You know what I'm saying? What we've been through, what we represent, the length of time that we've been here doing what we do, the fact that people have been supporting us, you know, for one, financially. You know what I'm saying? All my bills and different things like that are paid because people come to my shows, people buy my music, or other artists that like me buy verses from me. That's how I take care of my family. So there's an appreciation for my art and appreciation for those that appreciate my art. And you just have to keep it real with people out here nowadays, you know? You have to let people know, man, like, this world is very real. It doesn't matter if you're a Bun B, you know what I'm saying? Shit will still fuck you up. You can still get crossed out in this game. You just gotta know how to persevere and ride through the shit. A lot of people, I can tell them, you probably gonna have a bad run, but it might not be as rough as mine. But if I can make it through this shit, and UGK can still be here, then anybody can do it. And that's what UGK really means, that anybody can be an underground king. Most people in this world are underdogs, but that doesn't mean that you're gonna stay an underdog. And don't let the fact that people don't appreciate you today stop you from being who you wanna be tomorrow. You have to keep that in mind.
So I reckon that after Pimp went to jail, it was kind of hard for you. You said you were just sitting around for almost 18 months and not knowing what to do. Right now, where the situation is even harder, it seems to be completely different. Is that something that you learned from that situation?
Absolutely. Had we not had the Free Pimp C movement with Pimp C going to prison and whatnot, we would not have known that we could persevere through his death had we not persevered through his imprisonment. Because it's, you know, we look back now and we realize that that was him being locked up was the test for me, was the test for the people around me and the people who had been working with this group for so long. That was, could you do it by yourself? I didn't understand it then. It makes all the sense in the world now that, you know, unfortunately that I was gonna have to continue this by myself. But that now we all know that I'm capable of doing it by myself. You know what I'm saying? So I just have to make sure that you know, I'm based right. You know what I'm saying? Make sure that you're focused, that you always know what the purpose is and what the point is of what you're doing, and just have the right people around you mash on it. And that's what it is. People know that we know we can do it because unfortunately we've had to do it before.
The whole rent responsibility thing you were talking about, or I don't know, being influential for young artists and helping them, does that go beyond career issues or music business issues? Do you feel some responsibility in other respects too when it comes to, I don't know, politics or drugs or whatever?
Absolutely. Just because I make music doesn't mean that I'm not beholden to the same laws that everyone else is in my community. And it's important that I show people that I care about the same things that everybody else in my community cares about. So, you know, it's important for me, you know, because I'm a parent, I'm actually gonna be a grandparent next week, which sounds crazy, right? I'm 35 years old, I'm gonna be a grandfather. Don't go there. But it's important that people understand, you know, that, you know, I'm still a person. Like, I still have to pay taxes. I still got to vote, you know what I'm saying? Shit like that. So the shit that's going on in my community still affects me. Even if it doesn't affect me directly, I can't sit back and let them fuck over you. Even if I've gotten to the point where they can't necessarily fuck over me, but then at the same time, I have to understand it because I have more to lose as well. So, and then at the end of the day, being a human being, you know, I have responsibilities to the world, you know what I'm saying? I have, you know, I have to show compassion for people that don't have what I have. I have to show concern for people being mistreated around the world. As an entertainer or a person, I like to call myself a person of influence. I wouldn't say I was a role model, but people are definitely influenced by the things I say and do. So I gotta make sure that it's not always, quote, bad shit that I'm saying or doing, you know what I'm saying? You have to equalize the effect. I understand that I made some records in my time that have some pretty raw, raunchy, wow, did he really say that type of shit. You know what I'm saying? Half the songs, well, you say half, probably 80% of the shit I made, I wouldn't dare play in front of my mother. Like, my mom has my first album, and if I took it right now and put it in the tape deck, it would pick up from the second part. The first album comes on and it says, Pimp C, bitch, and that's all she heard. She put it in, she said, I want to hear what y'all doing. Pimp C, bitch, cut that off. I don't want to hear this shit. Get this away from me. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, we saying all that to say, you know, I do feel the right to, you know, or the need rather, to get involved with certain things. Of course, politically, I know that I inspire people, so I should be inspiring people to get involved with the voting process. I try to be as fair as possible and not tell people who to vote for. But it's important for people to get involved with the process because a lot of times, especially in America, in the inner city, in the hood, they don't even approach us about voting until it's a presidential election. But keep in mind that there's also state shit that goes on, there's city shit, local community shit. Even in your respective community, they may be passing laws for the school or dress code or, you know, you can't play your car, your music loud after 10 o'clock or shit like that. And if you don't know about these things and you're not, you know, registered to go and vote on that shit, people will always be making decisions for you. So that's what I've been trying to do is get people involved with the process just so they can start having say. I tell people all the time, like, do you know you can go to your senator's office anytime you want and talk shit? Like, if you don't like some shit that your representative is doing, you can go to his office and be like, where the fuck is Nick Lanson at? Where's the senator, goddammit? They supposed to fix my street 3 years ago. They ain't doing this shit. Where the fuck is my representative? I pay taxes. I voted for this son of a bitch. Where is he? You have the right to do that when you vote. But most people that complain don't do shit about it. They actually just like to complain. And it's time to stop talking and start doing. And I know that for me, I can get people energized. If I say Benz is the new car, you know, people will go and buy Benzes. So if I tell people voting is the new shit, maybe they'll go out and vote, you know, and try to make the process as easy, you know what I'm saying? And just get people involved with the world, man. Too many people are just sitting around just looking at the world go by, being fucked up, and just, you know, just, it's fucked up out here. Like, take charge. That's what's wrong. That's why the world is so fucked up, because there's so many people who just don't want to do nothing about what's going on, you know? And I'm just trying to, you know, light a fire under some asses right now.
So with the situation right now where everybody seems to feel like he needs to have the Obama record, needs to have the Obama mixtape or whatever, do you still think it's a good thing? I mean, in the end, it's not like all those rappers who represent Obama now make people think about it. It's like they make the decision for them. But do you still think it's a good thing?
I mean, it's good to get people involved right now and you know, Obama's the first candidate that would have had people.
But do they get people involved in it? I mean,
yeah, I mean, they are getting some. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing. I got, say, for example, I'm a gold artist. The gold in America, that means I've sold 500,000 records. So if I say go vote, does that mean 500,000 people are going to go vote? Fuck no. Those people like different things. Everybody doesn't like the same thing about me. You know what I'm saying? Some people like the style. Some people like the music. Some people like the content. Some people like the whole package. It's just to try to get people involved with it. That being said, we have a lot of people jumping on the bandwagon, making songs about Obama, but really don't know his policies or none of that shit. And a lot of these same people that like Obama today, not gonna like him no more when he's president. You know what I'm saying? Everybody always has some issues at some point with their standing president. And a lot of people are just jumping on the bandwagon and getting in the hype. You know what I'm saying? I talk to cats all the time. I'm like, yeah, man, Obama for president. I'm like, okay, so you gonna vote? Nah, man, but I'm down with him. I'm riding with him. What the fuck that got to do with anything if you down with him? You gotta vote for him to win. So he ain't gonna just win? Fuck no, he not gonna. You think he won already? Shit, everybody talking about Obama. Hell no, you got to get in the game. A lot of people, you know, they so separate from the process, they don't even understand. So we got to get people involved, you know?
So you think what is happening right now, will that change anything? I mean, obviously, before even, like, the election has not even happened, and still Obama is this kind of pop culture icon or whatever that brushes his shoulder off in front of a camera and everybody seems to like it. You know, but he came to Europe, like, everybody was crazy about it. There were, like, hundreds of thousands of people just to watch him speak. And do you think that already some sort of change is already going on?
Absolutely, because of the fact that to see a person unlike, and it, you know, I say this to a lot of people, it's not just that Obama is black, it's because he's different. If he was a Hispanic,
in what respect?
Huh?
Why is he different? What makes him different?
I just think the fact that he inspires hope is the fact that he looks different than everything that's come before him. You know what I'm saying? Every president before Barack Obama, Possibly with the exception of Clinton and Kennedy, but for the most of them pretty much look like the ones before them. You know what I'm saying? It's not, if you put up a picture of George Bush and a picture of George Washington, it's not that much of a difference, but about 6 inches. You know what I'm saying? It pretty much looked like the same motherfucker. They could have been his, you know, his grandchild or some shit like that. Well, great, 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 great grandchild. But to say that is that, you know, America has always said it's the melting pot. America has always said that we're open to all these different cultures and all these different races and all these different, whatever you say, whatever. We welcome everybody, you know what I'm saying? The country's never reflected that. And for the first time, we have a candidate that actually reflects what America looks like. Like I said, he could have been Hispanic, he could have been an Asian, he could have been European, but it's just the fact that it's different now. And the world is so fucked up and people are so disenfranchised about every fucking thing. You know what I'm saying? Family, friends, the economy, my house, my car, everything is fucking people up. And nothing no one says makes anyone feel the slightest bit better until Barack talks. It's sincere and it's genuine. If it's not, he's the best liar God put on this planet, point blank, period. I honestly believe that he wants change. Can he actually make change with our help? Yes, he can, but he cannot do it alone. We have to support the man beyond the election, and we have to hold him to his shit. That's the main thing. Like, don't just vote for Barack. This is for my people that are probably going to see this online or whatever. Don't just vote for the man because everybody else is. And then when he's elected, just, okay, so we're going to be good now. No, we got to make sure that he's, you know, that he makes good on his promises. We have to hold him to the standard that he's putting up there, you know?
Don't you think it's pretty sure that we'll come to a point where he actually has to make a decision he maybe doesn't even want to take, or that goes against what he says now? Like, isn't that sort of in the nature of being president? And could that be even a bigger problem? Like, I don't know, when George Bush was president, maybe not too many people were expecting too much.
Right.
And he was just another president. So, and if now some person steps up and everybody has this high expectations and really expects him to change the whole world, maybe, and not less, don't you think it would be even more of a problem if he cannot really hold on to that?
That's the thing. It's not that, you know, we expect him to change the world, because, you
know, I think a lot of people do, yeah.
Well, I mean, he's just one man. Like, he's only as powerful as the country he represents. And it's going to be up to not just the president of America, but Americans as well. Like, we have to believe in his message of change and be prepared to go out and start making the change. Like, we as citizens have to help him make America a better country. We have to start looking out for our fellow man more. We have to be more environmentally conscious. We have to be more understanding to other people and cultures and lifestyles. All of this is what we have to do as Americans to help make America a great country again. He is the person that wants to help us do this. He is the person that is inspiring us to be better people. A McCain will only make people feel worse about the state of the world that they're living in now. It's like, okay, great. 4 more years of Bush. This world is going to shit. Why should I even get up and go to work? Why should I give a fuck anymore? Barack is telling people, you know what? This country can be great again if we believe it. But we don't believe it when the other guy's talking.
So it's more about motivation than actual politics?
Absolutely.
So young Jeezy could be president?
I hope so. It would be a reflection of the inner cities of America, you know? The thing in America is that anyone is supposed to be able to become president. The fact that, you know, a president's son became president kind of fucked that message up for people. And it made it seem like, you know what, this shit's an inside job. Like, this motherfucker has no qualifications for being president other than the fact that his daddy was president. You know what I'm saying? That's alumni shit. What the fuck is that? You know what I'm saying? So, people are just tired of the same old shit, and they're tired of this guy getting this guy in, and everybody that's of power and of influence, you know what I'm saying, in America, they're all helping each other. You know, it's just the top 3% of the world running everything else. You know what I'm saying? It's no different in America than anywhere else. And people are just tired of it. Like, we're a democracy. The people are supposed to fucking run this shit. But we haven't had representation to tell us, hey, look, you're supposed to be telling me what to do. You're supposed to be doing it. Now we do. Up until then, people have always been saying, trust me, I know what's good for you. Barack is telling us to trust in ourselves. That's the difference.
So that's very similar to what you are doing, right? In a way. I mean, that's pretty much the same words you used when you were talking about your first album, right?
You brought that shit around, didn't you? I don't know. I guess if you say so, like I said, I don't ride around with the mirror in my face all day, so I don't know. But I mean, that, you know, I guess I am trying to inspire lyricists to make, you know, better music and be better people, you know what I'm saying? Because I know how we get looked at a lot, and it's time to just start changing the perception of a lot of shit, you know? But shit, if I could be hip hop's Barack, yeah, I'm with that. And they can make all the songs about me they want.
So I think that might be a good point to ask you if you have any questions.
Please, anybody?
Mike?
Hi.
Hello.
I'm Michael from Israel.
What's up, Mike?
I just wanted to know how, you know, you said that back in the day when hip-hop just started out in the South, you would listen to a lot of the shit that was going on in New York and the West Coast and everything. But how did the people, like, producing hip-hop in the South and rapping in the South, how did they come up with the sound, with the distinctive sound, with the slow tempos and the whole style? Because it is a distinctive musical style in hip-hop. It's not just trying to do something else. You know what I mean?
If you look at New York, New York is a city where there's, New York has, you know, it's the place where most immigrants come into the country. So a lot of what goes on in New York is very international. It's very cosmopolitan. There's a lot of influences from a lot of places. And a lot of people, you know, rap is basically disco music mixed with Jamaican, you know what I'm saying, DJ sounds put together. So that's the influence for the East Coast. The West Coast has more of a rock tinge to it, a lot of guitars and shit like that, because most of the music coming out of LA, you know, is being made in that area is rock based. In the South, most of us in the South, our parents listen to blues, a lot of blues records, and a lot of gospel. Most Southern producers are heavily influenced by gospel and blues and early R&B. We pretty much are making a lot of the music that we listen to. For a long time, it was subconsciously. We didn't even really notice it. Now that we're more cognizant of it, we try to put as much influence into it as we can, just to give our music more of its own personal distinction. Also, jazz. A lot of people don't know that a lot of Southern artists, because of course they think we're stupid, we listen to a lot of jazz music, and there's a lot of influence in that, but not so much the sampling of jazz, but more of instrumentation. Southern artists, more than artists from any other region, use live instrumentation in their music. And a lot of that comes to the fact that, you know, most musicians are from the South. There's just, you know, there's a guitar player everywhere you look. And it's a certain thickness. When you listen to Southern music, there's a thickness in it. You know what I'm saying? That comes from the strings of the guitar, the strings of the bass guitar, the keys on the piano. You know what I'm saying? It's just a different sound, and that basically just comes from the music that we listen to coming up.
Don't you think it has a lot to do with how and where people are actually listening to music? I think when you're from New York, you take the subway, you're listening to music on your Walkman or now on your iPod or whatever. You mentioned before that, like, in Houston, Texas is so big, you need to have a car, and you listen to the music when you're in the car, and I think the same thing goes for L.A. I think that really has a huge influence on how music sounds. Would you agree on that?
I agree. I could agree with that, definitely, because a lot of, and then again, you have to be careful about that, too, because you almost want to say that a lot of East Coast music isn't bass influence. But a lot of the early hip-hop was 808, the Marley Marl records, and a lot of that had a lot of bass in it because they were making music for the park, to actually be played outside. But I do understand that the philosophy of living in a city where, you know, most of your transportation is public. So, you know what I'm saying, you have to condense whatever you're doing to your own personal space. Hence the iPod or personal computers and things like that. So I totally understand that. And I do believe that it has an influence in it, because why would you put a lot of bass in your music for people who aren't gonna listen to it with a big stereo. That being said, you know, you can buy some headphones now that sound like a goddamn car when you put them on. You know, some of that skull candy shit, I can't even put that shit on my ears like that because it's too goddamn loud, you know?
So I know that Jay-Z has a theory that a good song has to work on like the most shitty speakers ever. And if it doesn't work on that on those speakers, it's not a good song. So what's your take on that coming from a Southern perspective?
That's absolutely, positively, 100% true. When you get out of it, you go in the studio, one of these big control rooms with all these monitors and these big ass woofers, I don't give a fuck what you play. That shit sound good. I don't give a fuck what kind of music it is. If you play it loud enough on the right stereo, that shit sounds great. But then you take that shit and translate it to another form, and that shit don't work at all. One thing we used to do, and a lot of people do this, you take whatever you do in the studio, and you take it to the, you know, you go to a little battery-operated CD player, like the shit with one little speaker and a tape deck, and you just play. And if that, not some Blaupunk shit, you know what I'm saying, some cheap-ass $30 out of Walmart-ass boombox. If that shit jams in there, it's gonna jam in anything. And that's as true as it is. If it don't make sense in there, because the majority of people aren't listening to music in big houses and stereos or in cars. They're listening to it on little shitty ass radios at home, you know?
Hi, I'm Sarah from London.
Hello.
Which is why I wanted to ask you about the Dizzee Rascal collaboration and how you first heard about him and what it was that he did that made you want to do a track together.
I met Dizzee Rascal at South by Southwest about, I would probably say about 5 years ago now, through Matt Sanzala, who books the rap acts at South by Southwest. And he was like, yeah, man, I'm bringing this dude in from London, man. This dude is hard. Like, he's incredible. I'm like, London? I never really heard of London MC. So he played, I want to say it was Fix Up Look Sharp for me. And I was like, this shit is hard. Like, this dude got some real fucking breath control. I was like, I like this. And then when he came and performed, and I really saw him doing some real grime shit, like some real high-speed, going-in, crazy-ass shit, I was like, this motherfucker's a problem. Then I talked to him. And it was a whole other story when I talked to him. Dizzee Rascal, in my opinion, is, and I want to make sure I say this right, I've never met a person anywhere in the world, in any class of life, doing anything that understands people as well as Dizzee Rascal does. It's got a lot to do with his own personal experience and the life that he's led, but he really gets it. Like, he understands. And I know this may sound crazy, but he understands everything. When I talk to him about shit, he has such a grasp on everything. And this kid's like 10 years younger than me, you know? And I was really impressed by the fact that he's not just, most people his age, when I met the kid was probably about 19, 20 years old. And most kids 20 years old, and they're the shit. They don't give a fuck about anything other than being the shit. When I was 20 years old, and I didn't give a fuck. I was the shit. That was all I wanted to be, was the shit. But this dude, he has compassion for other people. You know, he goes to these other countries and he doesn't just perform and take money. He really, you know, looks at what's going on with people's conditions and shit like that. And I really just ended up having a lot of respect for the young kid. And over the years, we were friends for three and a half years before we even went in the studio together. But it was like, you know what? We need to do a song because, you know, we, you know, where you're at and where I'm at, you know, in the game, like, we just need to come together and just show a connection right now. Nobody would see it coming, but Southern music and grime music have so many parallels in the delivery of the vocals to the production of the music, the tempo, the energy of the artist, as well as the energy of the crowd, you know what I'm saying? And it was just all about really just, you know, it being true, because, you know, a lot of times when rappers meet each other, that's the first thing they do is say, let's do a song. But they very seldom do the song. I don't even pay attention to that type of shit no more. Like, you meet somebody, yeah, man, take my number. You know what I'm saying? We'll link up, whatever, wham. And then when they know, they're going to change the number Monday anyway. You know what I'm saying? So, but he just really, you know, really intrigued me. Like, how could this young kid know so much about everything? And when I got to talk to him, it's just the life that he's led. He's really unfortunately been privy to a lot of shit in his life, you know? But he didn't let it bring him down like a lot of people I know let the shit they've been through make them. Like, whatever it was that happened to you in the past, whatever you've been through, that doesn't define who you are in that sense. Just because you're from nowhere, full of nothing people, doesn't mean you're nothing. You're who you want to be. You go as far as you want to go in life. And he's a real good example of that. And I wish he could get the success in America that he gets in London so that people could understand him as a person. Because I think if people got a chance to know him as a person, it would take him so much further in this game. You know what I'm saying? But sometimes we get locked into our artist identity and you don't get a chance to let people know who the real you are. Oh, and also he's a good ass rapper. That's why we did a song together. Yo.
I'm Reggie, I'm from Australia.
What's going on, Reggie?
Not much, man. This lecture, of course. But yeah, in Australia, we we got, UGK Records, and that's it. So we got East music, we got the West music, and then just recently, people are starting to get a bit more into the South. And I don't know, in Perth, where I'm from Perth, Australia, sometimes we have discussions on how maybe there's a bit of, attention or animosity between the East and the South, or the West and the South, or the East and the West. Like, do you connect with many people from the East? You know, I can see that you collaborate with Jay-Z and things like that.
Oh, what? Yeah, I got a lot of friends on the East Coast. I hear a lot of talk about there being problems with the East and the South, and it's really only the media trying to pump a lot of things up. Most of the people on the East Coast and people in the South, when we see each other, we kick it. Have fun, smoke, drink. Whatever else they do, pop pills, whatever the fuck, everybody does that shit. We have way more in common than we do differences. You know what I'm saying? The only time, I see any kind of iffy shit is around a war time, and that's just natural. That's got nothing to do with music. I'm sure when the Oscars come around, and whoever's nominated, not crazy about the other people either, no matter how you act socially. Oh, I respect all the nominees, and I'm just happy to be nominated. That's bullshit. You want to win. You get nominated, you want to win. That's why we do things for people to, acknowledge these things. You know what I'm saying? I'm sure that there's a couple of artists in the East Coast who probably don't like the success the South is getting. But I'm sure there were some artists in the South that didn't like it when the East Coast was on top. And the reality is that no region gets to claim this shit. At some point, Australia will get the crown. And everybody just gonna have to roll with that shit. You know what I'm saying? Nobody's gonna be the shit forever. And if you got it in your mind that once I'm the shit, you already lost. It's a baton passing. This rap music industry, all this shit, it's just a relay race. I get my chance on the top, then people stop fucking with me, they fuck with you, I pass you the baton, you get your run, and when your run is over, you pass the baton. What tends to happen is that some people try to hold on to the baton a little bit too long, and somebody gotta come and take the fucking baton from you, then you don't get it back. But if you can willingly say, you know what, this dude here is doing his thing, I'm finna just fall back, let him have it, a lot of times they'll honor that, respect that, and they'll be the people to bring you back. But if you shit on the next person coming up, because you see everybody in life twice, once on the way up, once on the way down. So how you treat people the first time will be how they treat you the second time. So a lot of times in the South, we had a lot of people I've had East Coast artists front on me when I was first coming up, Do I take that as a reason to just hate all East Coast artists? Fuck no. Maybe just this dude was a dick. You know what I'm saying? Because there's some dicks in the South, too. This bullshit music where I'm from, bullshit music where you from in Australia. That's the reality of the world. But there's also some real good shit, too. And there's no need to be a bitch about it. Just give everybody they do credit, So East, South, nowhere near the East, West. And even when it was the East and West, it really was just this dude didn't like this dude. It was nothing personal about the region. Just this dude is a dick. Anybody else? Look like that may be it.
Are we good?
I think that's it. I think they're done with me. Thank you all for listening to my mumblings and rumblings. And thank Red Bull for having me.